A sellout crowd at Raymond James Stadium today, maybe the largest in South Florida football history. People in the Tampa Bay area have college football fever, and that's no bull. South Florida football is only 11 years old, but the program has matured in spite of its youth. And now the Bulls are ranked number 5 in the nation. Today they play in-state rival Central Florida. The Knights are hungry for an upset today, and make no mistake, this is a huge rivalry. These players know each other. These teams used to be in the same conference, and the schools are only 82 miles apart. Hi again, everybody. Welcome to Tampa. Alongside my partner, Larry Coker, I'm Clay Matvick. And Larry, the South Florida program is riding high. They've got the highest ranking in team history. But last week, Florida Atlantic, another in-state rival, almost knocked them off. They know they better be careful today.
Clay, this program has come a long way and come very, very fast. And you're exactly right. This is a rivalry between these two programs. It's a very important football game, 82 miles apart. They know one another. They've played against one another in high school. Their coaches know one another, and it's huge for recruiting.
No question about it. And the man responsible for this meteoric rise is Jim Leavitt, the only coach this program has known. In fact, he built it from scratch 11 years ago.
I was at the University of Miami when they hired Jim Leavitt, a nothing program, basically. And now, 11 years later, you can feel the atmosphere now building in this stadium.
At the beginning of the season, this team was not ranked. This is how fast it has happened here in Tampa. A few weeks ago, not on the radar screen. And slowly but surely, they've made their way to the top 5.
Well, you just have to win. When you do that and you win, apparently you're going to move up and have a chance to be successful.
Sellout crowd here at Raymond James Stadium for this I-4 rivalry. And this Central Florida team pretty good too. In fact, if George O'Leary's squad gets a win over East Carolina last week, they're probably ranked.
Well, they're very disappointed they didn't. They had the lead in the second half. They turned the football over. Really cost them the football game.
This is only the third time that these two teams are meeting. Last year, the game was pretty close. A couple of years ago, it was not. And talking to both coaches here this week, Larry, they both expect that this could be decided in the fourth quarter.
Well, it could be decided on the last play. And that's the way you've got to coach a team, a game like this. Hey, get ready to win this football game on the last play of the game. And that just might happen in a game like this.
All right, Larry, let's get your keys to the game.
Well, I think the first thing for sure is you've got to stop the run. If you're South Florida, that's going to be huge. They have outstanding corners. They can rely on those guys to stop the pass outside, but they've got to stop the run.
Well, the Bulls have won the toss, and they have deferred, so Central Florida will start with it here. That is Justin Tichy kicking off for the Bulls. He had 3 touchbacks last week.
It's going to be huge for Central Florida to neutralize Matt Grothy, too. He's a very accurate passer, but he's especially deadly when he's on the run. He's an outstanding runner.
And we're underway in Tampa. Curtis Francis takes it from his own 5. Has a seam, a good return out over the 30 to the 34-yard line, and that's where Central Florida was set up.
Curtis Francis on the return.
It's a 29-yard return. Kyle Israel is the quarterback for the Golden Knights. Coming off a season-high 308 yards passing last week in the loss to East Carolina. But he had 2 costly interceptions in the second half that both led to scores. And Larry, the scouting report on him is he probably won't win you a lot of games with his talent, but he could lose you some. So he needs to have a good game.
Well, you hate to say manage the game, but I think he really has to do that.
First play of the game. They go right to the ground. And that's Kevin Smith. And he's strung out to the near sideline.
And off to number 24, Kevin Smith.
And we take a look at the starting lineup. Nobody better in the country right now on the ground than Kevin Smith, leading the nation 172 yards per game. He has 11 rushing touchdowns. The Knights experienced up front, and one of the main reasons that Smith is doing so well on the ground. Kyle Smith, no relation, making his 38th consecutive start today at center. Israel out of the gun. Penalty flags down, and this play is whistled dead. And noise is certainly going to be a factor here. This is an electric crowd already.
Well, you can really feel the atmosphere, and I've never been to a USF game on the road, but again, you can really feel the atmosphere. It's going to be a great crowd.
So a false start on Central Florida. And penalties, mistakes, certainly turnovers, something Central Florida can't afford too many of today.
Not at all.
Second and 15. Seven-step drop, Israel going down. George Selvey, who leads the nation with 10.5 sacks, make it 11.5 now, gets in there to take Israel down for a huge loss. The Bulls have the nation's leader in sacks. You just saw him, George Selvey. And he is very hard to stop off that right edge. Ben Moffitt is the team's leader on defense. He's kind of a throwback at middle linebacker. And the secondary has been the strength of this South Florida D. Mike Jenkins, probably the top cornerback in the country. Third and forever. Israel gets it off underneath to Smith. Out over the 20 and pulled down, and Central Florida is going to go to their punting unit.
Well, Wally Burnham's defense at South Florida, they're very fast, very, very fast. He's going to attack Central Florida, and you can see that. That's certainly the way that the Bulls wanted to start out, and not the way Central Florida wants to start.
South Florida defense has been something else. They've created 18 turnovers.
Should be great field position for South Florida. Nearly blocked the punt.
Marcus Edwards nowhere to run, but still pretty good field position here at the 37-yard line for South Florida to start.
South Florida had the punt block on, so they didn't really have a return set up. But again, still outstanding field position for the South Florida Bulls.
Matt Brophy, the dual threat quarterback, 5 touchdown passes. But he also gets a lot done with his feet. The Big East Rookie of the Year last year. And everyone wondered what this guy could do for an encore. We're finding out. He's 13-4 as the Bulls starter. High snap, brings it back down and is able to hand off to Jamar Taylor. Taylor was at Alabama before transferring to South Florida. Jamar Taylor. Now Benjamin Williams walked on here in South Florida. Now he is the feature back for the fifth-ranked team of the nation. He had 4 touchdowns last week. The Bulls have just one senior on the line. That's Walter Walker.
See a lot of Florida players on this, on both these football teams. Had one player, a Hill from the South Georgia.
Second and 8. Brophy's going to keep it himself. And not a lot of operating room straight ahead. And Brophy is one of those players who will call his number quite a bit. Central Florida has never beaten a ranked opponent. To change that today, they're going to need a big day on defense. Keith Shaw again, a veteran defensive tackle. All H's in the linebacking core. Hallman, Henderson, and Hogue. And in the defensive backfield, Joe Burnett is the Knights' top cover man. 3rd and 6 here. Brophy out of the gun, looks left, now starts it back right on the ground, throws on the run to the sideline, and out of bounds. It was caught, but the receiver, Dontavia Bogan, was out of bounds. So now South Florida will have to punt, but hold on, there is a penalty flag there.
Marcus Edwards, incomplete. 4th down and 6. Delbert Alvarado will punt for the Bulls.
So the Bulls will have to punt anyway.
Well, again, it was a nice catch on the boundary, but the college rule different than the pro rule. Caught the football, but came down out of bounds. You have to come down with 1 foot in bounds to make it a catch, a legal catch in college football.
This is going to take a bounce at the 25-yard line, and South Florida says they have it. And the Bulls have recovered. A mistake by Joe Burnett.
Very difficult mistake this early in the game. And again, especially on the road, a hostile crowd.
Number 22, Ryan Gilliam.
I think have a call. He just needs to get away from it. You either need to fair catch it, field it, or get away from the football.
It appears that Ryan Gilliam has recovered.
Again, just a mistake on the kicking team, the special teams for Central Florida. A huge mistake. A good job by the Central Florida defense forcing the punt. And now that's one possession that Central Florida will not be allowed to have during this game.
Turnovers were the Achilles heel for Central Florida last week against East Carolina. They committed 5. Now Grothy and company back with the football. First down and 10. Ball at the 27-yard line of Central Florida. Handoff. And this is Benjamin Williams with his first carry of the day and little or no gain.
Well, I think South Florida has a little different spread offense. They're more of a one-back offense, traditional one-back offense in spread. They'll play with a tight end. They'll play with two tight ends. They'll also run some spread plays. But they're more of a downhill tight zone offensive football team than a spread lateral east and west football team.
Actually, a loss of 1 on that play, 2nd and 11. Now Grothy looks back to the sideline. He'll check the play.
Play being called from the sideline at this time, probably from the press box, actually, to the sideline.
Plenty of time to throw. Grothy comes up underneath, and it's Williams. And it's going to be a pickup of about 3 yards on the play.
Well, the Bulls tried to clear out and run verticals and then come underneath with the back. And, again, pretty good defense by, obviously, by Central Florida.
South Florida, Larry, has scored first in all 5 of its games. So getting a break like they've just been handed. And if they're able to put it in the end zone, that's going to go a long way to setting the tempo here today. That's what they're trying to do. Grothy, plenty of time. Now the pocket closes down on him. He's very dangerous on his feet. Doesn't look like he has enough for the first down. It appears he's a yard short. John L. Neal escorted him out of bounds.
This will be a huge victory for Central Florida if they can hold South Florida to a field goal attempt here. South Florida's been good in the red zone with touchdowns. They have not been that good at kicking field goals in the red zone. Out of the Auburn game, I believe 4 field goals were missed in the red zone of the Auburn game.
Yeah, they're only 77% on the season in the red zone. Only 60% touchdowns.
I think maybe that's why they're going for it on 4th down.
No question. 4th and 1. Grothy keeps it himself, and it appears he has enough.
They were spreading out the Central Florida defense, and to get a crease, just needed a yard. A nice fake by Grothy, and again, a good tough run.
Well, offensive coordinator Greg Gregory told us yesterday the passing game has not been that good. But because Grothy is a competitor, he's cranked it up running the football. And that's what he had to do to beat West Virginia a couple of weeks ago and Florida Atlantic last week. And you can see on the important plays like that one, they go right to Grothy.
Now, this is going to be interesting because I don't think he got a great spot on this. This will be a little closer than I thought it was. About half a football. That's a huge first down. That's an easy first down. Half a football. Grothy's kind of that type of quarterback. He gives South Florida what they need. He usually doesn't come up short.
Jim Leavitt says the guy has moxie.
Says he has moxie. He has moxie.
Little reverse here. And this is Taurus Johnson. And he's going to be stopped in the backfield. John L. Neal, the cornerback, coming up to make the tackle.
Taurus Johnson on the carry.
Also, Jason Vinson, the free safety, in on the play.
It's a nice job by Neal staying at home and playing the reverse and really chasing the ball. Really nice job by Central Florida chasing the football.
So second and 12. Brophy's going to keep it again. And I'll tell you what, Central Florida is keying on him. And they've done a pretty good job on Brophy so far.
Well, they're well coached. George O'Leary's an outstanding football coach.
And
Central Florida, they have a very good football team. They've lost a couple of football games, but they're a good team. And I think South Florida knows that, and I know Central Florida knows that.
Look at the season numbers. Averaging 182 yards passing per game. Needs 91 to make it 1,000 for the season. He's going to go to the air. Back of the end zone, had a receiver open. Amari Jackson, the junior out of Sarasota, was back on that end line in the end zone, but it was a little too tall.
A little tall. That's a pretty good throw, though. He got the ball up. Still leaves a field goal opportunity for his offensive football team and a chance to get points on the board. This is a good series for Central Florida to hold South Florida to a field goal attempt. Now let's see how much they've improved on their field goals.
And you mentioned just 5 for 10 on field goals this year is Alvarado. They missed 5 red zone field goals already this year. And this is going to be a 34-yard attempt for Delbert Alvarado, the sophomore out of right here in Tampa. And he's got it. Well, the Bulls would rather have had 6, but they get 3. Well, because South Florida is fairly new to the national spotlight, we're going to get to know the team and school better by playing a little game. And the students here at USF are going to help us when we come back. It's the I-4 rivalry. In the first quarter in South Florida, the number 5 team of the nation on top over Central Florida, 3-0. And Larry, again, South Florida has struck first in all 6 of their games now. And certainly that has helped.
Well, no doubt about it. I think it gets momentum. It's got the crowd still in the football game. And again, I think it just generates excitement. And now the South Florida defense, you can see what they're all about. They're going to fly around and make some plays.
Central Florida lost last week to East Carolina 52-38, even though they led at the half 28-17. So they're a little angry after last week. And to make things right, an upset over a ranked South Florida team would help, especially on the road.
I don't believe George O'Leary would say this would make their season, but I believe this would make their season if they would win this football game today.
Torres kicking off. And Curtis Francis with his second return. And again out over the 30 to the 32-yard line. All right, we're going to play bull or no bull. Larry, are you ready?
Ready to go.
South Florida is new to the national spotlight because of this football program, and some of the students are going to help us learn more about this school and football team. We're going to bring in Dexter Butler, a middle infielder on the South Florida baseball team. And, Dexter, how you doing today?
I'm doing all right. Thanks for having me.
All right, we're ready to play bull or no bull.
All right, I got a few questions for you guys. First one. University of South Florida was founded in 1918. Bull or no bull?
1918. I'm going to say bull.
I'm going to say bull.
Y'all got that one right. No, y'all got that one. Y'all got that one wrong.
We got that wrong? It was
founded
in 1918.
University of South Florida was founded in 1956, had an enrollment of 2,000 students. Today, they're over 44,000.
So we did get it right.
Yeah, y'all got it right. I'm sorry. Y'all got it right.
Hey, don't mess with us now, Dexter.
This is hard enough. All right, hang on. We'll get the next question in a minute. Second down and 8. This crowd is amped up, making it tough on this Central Florida team. Israel out of the gun, looks to his right, throws, and it's picked off. The 12th interception of the year by the South Florida defense. And this time it's Mike Jenkins, who Mel Kiper considers the top senior quarterback in the country and maybe the 10th best NFL prospect overall, and you can see why.
I believe Kyle Israel was a little late with the ball. You can see here, he's really staring down the receiver, and a nice break by Mike Jenkins. He really jumps the throw and has hands like a wide receiver. I really like what I've seen out of Jenkins. See how delayed that Israel is, and now Jenkins just undercuts, runs the route, completes the route for the receiver, makes the interception.
So Grothy goes back to work, throw it deep to the end zone, has a man in and out of the hands of Carlton Mitchell. The Bulls' number four receiver looking for his second touchdown grab of the year. Probably should have had it.
You're not going to throw any better than that. You got to come up with that play, and Carlton Mitchell knows that. He'll hate to see that video on tape Sunday. Great protection. Really lays the ball up. There's no free safety. You can see right through the hands of Mitchell. Great throw.
So it'll bring up second down and 10. We're going to get back to Bull or no Bull in a second. I know, Larry, you're chomping at the bit. You can't wait. Grothy wants to throw again on second down. Coming to his right on the run. Heaves it downfield. Another man open and again falls incomplete. This time, Amari Jackson. And pretty good coverage by Neal, the cornerback in the secondary.
Amari Jackson, incomplete.
All right, Dexter, let's go back to Bull or no Bull. What's your second question?
All right, question two. A leading medical research institution, USF Chief Biotechnology Researcher Dr. Michaela Quinn, was the basis for the character of the same name on the popular TV series Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman.
That's no Bull.
No Bull?
No Bull.
I'm going to agree with you, Larry, because I don't think that you could make that up. No Bull. Grothy in trouble. He is so elusive. And again, deep downfield. Caught inside the 5-yard line, Taurus Johnson. That is what Grothy can do. He makes something out of nothing.
That's also what Taurus Johnson can do. He's done that several times throughout his career here. He just gets open, and he can make that big play. We've had a couple drops that have been big. That's a big play by Taurus Johnson.
A 34-yard reception by Johnson, the team's second leading receiver. First and goal. Touchdown, Mike Ford. The freshman out of Sarasota takes it in from 4 yards out, and Ford has been impressive in his rookie year. Williams is the feature back, but Ford gets his share of carries too.
You can see Greg Gregory has his personality on this offense. Again, it's a spread type offense, a one back offense, but they do use a lot of power plays and some tight ends in this offense. Really helps the defense also.
Alvarado with the extra point, and it's 10-0 South Florida. All right, Delbert, were we right? We said no Bull. We both said no Bull.
Yeah, I got Bull on that one. While USF is classified as a research university of very high research activity for its biotechnology and bioscience research, records indicated Dr. Michaela Quinn was never on the staff. Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman, however, remains the most frequently recorded show on Larry Coker's TiVo.
All right, Dexter, you got one more for us?
One more. USF head football coach Jim Leavitt was the 1976 Big 8 batting title. He won the 1976 Big 8 batting title as a member of the University of Missouri baseball team.
That's Bull. He played football in Missouri. I don't think he played baseball in Missouri. That's Bull.
I'll say no Bull.
All right, I got no Bull. Coach Leavitt batted 386 with 67 RBIs in 1976 for Missouri.
All right, so I got the lead on you, Larry.
Oh.
Hey, Dexter, thanks very much, and good luck on this year's baseball team.
All right, thanks, for
thanks Dexter.
That's right. Dexter Butler. He's a senior here at USF. Justin Tichy kicking off. One of the up men takes a good field position here for Central Florida as they find themselves down 10-0, and it's mistakes here early on for Central Florida that have them in this hole.
Definitely mistakes, and I think Central Florida knows that they have to, with the scrambling of growth, they've got to cover and they've got to stay locked up for a long time, but that's easier said than done. Very difficult to do for a long period of time. Those guys are going to get open if they lose contain with their defensive front and allow Grothy to scramble.
George O'Leary feels the Knights can contend for that East Division title in Conference USA even after that loss to East Carolina last week.
Conference USA is a good league.
Clock issue. They've got it worked out there. Kevin Smith finds some room around the corner, got it to midfield, and he walks out of bounds. 6-yard gain. Let's go to the studio for the first time, and Mike Gleason.
Clay, Rutgers hoping to avoid slipping to 3-3. Mike Teal throws his sixth INT. Andrew Robinson capitalizes, finds Mike Williams. Syracuse on top, 7-0. Michigan with the lead over Purdue, is he?
Yeah, Chad Henne still getting his groove back, throwing the ball well, hooking up with his favorite receiver, Mario Manningham.
Michigan 7-0 over the Boilermakers in the Big House. Clay?
Mike, Steve, thank you very much. Here's Smith again, and he's got enough for the first down. And they go to him a lot, Larry. He's got 62% of the team's carries coming into the day.
Well, he has over 40% of their offense. And I think the thing, this is what UCF needs to do. I like what George O'Leary's doing here. He's settling his guys down, running some things that they're very comfortable with, getting it back, a little momentum back, getting a little flow of the offense, in good field position, and now getting the ball in the hands of their best playmaker, the guy that's going to have to take charge for them to win this football game, Kevin Smith.
First time that Central Florida has been in South Florida territory. Smith again cuts it to the outside. He's upended at the 33-yard line by the corner, Trey Williams. And the coaching staff calls Williams the most consistent player in the secondary. And that's saying something because you've also got Jenkins back there.
Well, you do. I think the thing you have with Williams is you have a little more physical player than Jenkins. Jenkins is a great cover corner. I think Williams is probably a little more complete player, cover corner, as well as a physical outstanding tackler.
One thing's for sure, both of them are coveted by NFL teams.
No doubt about it.
We send the tight end Rubinsky in motion. Smith into the secondary and down at the 15-yard line. First down and 10 for Central Florida. Let's again check in with Mike.
Well, Clay, remember what Syracuse did to Louisville. Now Rutgers on the other end. Here comes the big orange again. Curtis Brinkley. He scores. It's 14-0 orange.
And Ohio State, Todd Beckman goes to his slot receiver, Bryant Hartline. Beats the corner inside for the slant and for the touchdown.
15th scoring strike for Beckman, Clay.
Thank you very much, guys. First down and 10 for the Knights. Inside the 5-yard line, Kevin Smith. And this is a big drive for Central Florida.
It's a huge drive for Central Florida, and I'm very impressed. And just now to finish it, and again, a little kick-out play, and a nice job by Smith. Look at him in the open field, breaking tackles. Nice cut. He's an outstanding north and south runner.
Five straight 100-yard rushing games. Meanwhile, South Florida hasn't allowed a 100-yard rusher in 13 straight. It's Smith again, and he stopped right at the threshold.
Well, Smith had 5 yards rushing last year against South Florida. He's already quite a bit better than that now. And you can see he's a very difficult back to tackle and an outstanding runner upfield. Again, I think South Florida is going to have to add the safeties in to stop Kevin Smith.
Smith, 7 carries for 40 yards already today. Second down and goal coming up. Israel turns, hands off, stopped in the backfield. Smith goes down. Several players shooting in there, leading the way, number 95, George Selby. Kevin Smith.
It's a great call by Wally Burnham on defense. You know, watch the pinching of the defensive front. Everybody coming inside expecting Smith to get the football, and it's a great call by Wally Burnham. And
well, Wally Burnham said yesterday to us, we've got to stop Kevin Smith. We've got to contain him. They forced a third and goal situation here. They want to throw it to the end zone. Israel picks his way and finds it. Got to the end zone somehow. Didn't look like he was going to have a throw. Realized that and took it in himself. Touchdown, Central Florida.
That may be what Central Florida needs, is to have that type play. And again, he drops back. Look at the crease open up. And a good job by Israel. And a nice job running. Nice cut. Protecting the football. This was a huge drive for Central Florida. They're right back in the football game on the road, and they needed that.
Michael Torres on for the extra point. And it's 10-7. So the Knights take a couple of punches to the jaw. Bounce back here, and they're down three with 4:21 to go in the first quarter. Kyle Israel, the senior quarterback for the Knights, scoring the touchdown. And Central Florida back in the game. ESPNU College Football is presented by Allstate. Are you in good hands? The South Florida Bulls, number 5 in the country, and top 10-7 over Central Florida, their I-4 rivals. 8 plays, 56 yards, a little over 3 minutes, and Israel takes it in. It was an important drive for Central Florida, and they got it done.
It really is. I'm really impressed with Central Florida on the road. Tough atmosphere, and you know, you're down 10, and you come back and you do the things that have been successful for you. And I think a lot of credit to that goes to George O'Leary. No panic, poise, go to your go-to guy, Kevin Smith, touchdown.
Michael Torres kicks off. Torres Johnson is going to bring it back. From inside his 10, starts it back out over the 30, spun down finally at the 37-yard line, but a very good return for Torres Johnson. College football on ESPNU continues Sunday afternoon as the Benedict Tigers take on the Kentucky State Thoroughbreds. SIAC College Football on ESPNU Sunday at 2:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. So a 30-yard return for Johnson, and South Florida will have the ball again. Matt Grothy has engineered one touchdown drive already.
Well, the new kickoff rule, you can see good field position for both these teams to start the drives, because kickoff from the 30, you're getting some good returns.
Grovey will start out of the gun. Will play action. Sets up at his 30-yard line, throws it downfield. A nice pass and catch. Johnson again caught it at the 49, and now down at the 49 of Central Florida territory. Now, they say that Johnson is the most explosive player among the receivers, coach. And Greg Gregory told us yesterday that's the guy they want to get the ball to more.
Yeah, he's very explosive, has been now for a few years. He's been a difference maker for this football team. And again, great protection by the offensive line to allow Grothy time to pick out Johnson.
First and 10 at the 49. Mike Ford. Already has a touchdown today. Looked like the ball came loose momentarily, but they rule it down. He's down at the 41. It's going to be about a yard short of the first down.
Well, that's a great first down call for South Florida. Again, nice job on the pull by the tackle. And again, the ball comes loose.
Oh, it did come loose.
South Florida recovered, but again, you've got to protect the football. I think the ball, well, it's hard to see from that angle, but I believe the ball came out, but it's a good recovery by South Florida.
And Dontavia Bogan recovered. There's Benjamin Williams again, and nowhere to go this time. So to bring up a third down situation, there's a loss on the play.
Tackle by number 92.
Loss of two.
The Central Florida defense, they play against the run a lot in spring practice and practice in the fall. So the running game from South Florida won't surprise Central Florida at all, because they see Kevin Williams about every day.
So third and four. Another deep ball. Almost caught. Edner Alson, the freshman out of right here in Tampa, juggled it and dropped it. But I'll tell you, Grothy has hit three receivers now. Probably all three should have been caught.
Well, the coaches yesterday were talking about his accuracy, and he has been very, very accurate thus far in the game, especially on the move. And, again, what a great throw. What a great throw. Those are throws you'd like to have back, or catches you'd like to have back, but you don't get those opportunities again.
And Grothy's numbers don't look all that impressive right now, but he's throwing the ball pretty well.
Throwing the ball very well.
Delbert Alvarado to punt. And this is going to bounce at the 6-yard line. It takes a South Florida roll, and they're going to down it at the 2. It's a tough field position for Central Florida and the Knights when we come back. South Florida in uncharted territory, ranked 5th for the first time in team history. This is what Jim Leavitt had to say about the ranking.
Well, to be nationally ranked is always it's always nice. I don't think there's anybody out there that would say I don't want to be ranked, and it really is. But I don't want it. I want to make sure our focus is playing good football, and doing all the right things. And I really try to stay focused on that.
It's got to be hard though to keep your players focused when there's so much attention on.
A lot of pressure on South Florida from that standpoint. They know the rankings. They understand it.
Smith fell down. He fell down in the end zone and he couldn't get out. It's a safety.
Safety.
After that 41-yard punt, pinned him at the 2-yard line. It was going to be dangerous down there anyway, and Smith slipped on the turf.
Well, that's a good call by the official. He slips down, and knee that goes down in the end zone. And it's a good call. They're going to review it, but I think the call is going to stand. You can see the knee go down right there. I don't believe the ball ever gets out of the end zone. I believe he's down. I believe it's going to be a safety. It's hard to tell from that angle, but I believe from what I've seen that the call will stand on the field. I don't believe there will be evidence to overturn this call.
Now, Kevin Smith has done such great things for this Central Florida offense throughout the course of the season. Again, 5 straight 100-yard rushing games coming into this one today, which is a school record. This is just unfortunate. He slips trying to change directions.
Well, it's great penetration by the South Florida defense. Just great penetration by them.
And the good news for South Florida is they'll get the football back.
Well, it is. This has been a disastrous quarter for Central Florida, but yet they're still only down a touchdown. You score a touchdown, you're ahead in this football game. So if they can get out of this quarter even 12-7 behind, that's still not as badly as things have happened for them. Still not a disaster. A lot of football left. I think this is a very important series for the Central Florida defense.
Well, Michael Torres will come back out for the free kick. Murphy and Johnson are back deep for South Florida. Against Central Florida, it's the mistakes that have hurt them, especially the last couple of weeks.
Last week against East Carolina, the turnovers late in the game really were disastrous for their football team. And again, the same thing in this first quarter. Caused the mistakes.
Torres drills it into the turf. Takes a bounce. Torres Johnson fields it around the 30-yard line. He's hit hard. And that's where South Florida will have it at the 37. Let's go back to Mike.
And, Clay, we head down to the Orange Bowl. Miami, Georgia Tech pretty much fighting for the lives. How about a fourth and one? Sean Bray McNeil, a true freshman, finds a lane, takes it to the house. 7-0 Canes on top of Georgia Tech.
Yeah, Rutgers down 14-0. Ray Rice gets him back in it. His 11th touchdown.
14-7. The Q's still on top of Rutgers, Clay.
And South Florida will be at Rutgers next week. Seen that Syracuse can pull upsets. Already beat Louisville earlier this year. Maybe they're going to knock off Rutgers today. Grothy on play action. Throws it to the far sideline. The intended receiver, Amari Jackson, lands incomplete out of bounds. 12-7 our score. The number 5 team in the country on top of Central Florida with 2:14 to go here in the first quarter.
A lot of first down passing for South Florida. Play action passing on first down. They've had some big play opportunities there. Again, that was good coverage by Central Florida. Not much in the passing game on that play.
Sellout crowd here at Raymond James Stadium. South Florida happy to be playing in front of their own sellout crowd for a change. They've done it on the road a few times. This is caught by Johnson. It's going to be about 6 yards short of the first down. It's going to be spotted at the 41-yard line. They've seen big crowds at West Virginia. Earlier this year at Auburn, they had a big crowd to play in front of, but they've got the crowd on its side for the first time this year.
I think that just shows you the direction this program is going, the commitment they have, and by Doug Willard, the athletic director, and the administration. And now you can see a full stadium. That's just an awesome growth in this program.
On 3rd and 6, Grothy. He's looking for the first down. Needed to get to the 47, and he's knocked out short at the 45.
The Central Florida defense has lost contain. They've put good pressure on Grothy, but they've lost contain. Look at the defensive end coming in here. Good job by Grothy. But again, they really run well. Watch Central Florida converge on the play. And again, nice play, knocking him out of bounds, short of the first down, forcing the punt. This was a huge defensive series for Central Florida.
So the Bulls will punt. And the Alvarado punt is going to go into the end zone. Joe Burnett lets it sail in. Let's go to the studio for an update. Mike Gleason again.
Clay, we go to the big house. Buckeyes score again. Hartline second.
Brian Harlow, I want you to see the move. Ooh! You see how he froze him with his stutter step, slow step. Now he turns on his speed. He picks up a couple blocks. Brian Hartline takes it in for the Buckeyes.
90 yards, 14-0 Buckeyes. And up in Michigan, Wolverines 10-7 over Purdue.
Okay, guys, thank you very much. Here's a look at the top 10 of the AP Top 25 poll. There you see South Florida right smack in the middle of it. Israel, the play fake. Receiver comes back, and making the catch is Rocky Ross, a junior out of Jacksonville. He was tied for the team lead with Kamar Aiken coming into the game with 18 catches and now has a 9-game streak with at least one catch.
Really a nice job coming back for the football, but again, great coverage by Mike Jenkins. This had to be a great throw, which it was, by Kyle Israel.
2nd and 4. Now for the first down, Kevin Smith.
Carry by Kevin Smith. Tackle by number 4.
I like Smith's patience. He sets that up. It's excellent blocking by the front of Central Florida, but nice patience. He sees the crease. Could have taken it inside, bounced it outside. Knew what he needed to have for a first down.
Tim Salem, the offensive coordinator for Central Florida, said, we're going to run to win, we'll throw to score. Maybe you can explain exactly what he meant on the next play here. Ball comes loose. It looks like Selvey knocked it away from Israel. And Jared Bowie has recovered for the Bulls.
Well, again, an attacking defense by South Florida just increases, and just they're very, very fast, very quick. to shoot gap. Again, the tackle was not quick enough to get down and make that play, and really no chance for Israel, the quarterback. And you can see right there, again, great job by Selvig. He's got great explosiveness. He's not big, he's about 230, but very explosive and has a great first step off the football.
Chancey actually on the recovery. And we never heard anything about Chancey this week talking with the coaching staff. He's not even listed on the 2D.
Not even listed, but Dan McCarney coaches those guys. And Dan does a great job, former head coach at Iowa State.
Here's Grothy inside the 10 and down at the 8-yard line. Leger Duzabel, the defensive end from the left side, finally made the tackle. But here are the Bulls knocking on the door again.
Again, this is such a tough quarter for Central Florida. And again, they've really caused it and put it on themselves, but you know, somehow they've got to come out of this and hopefully hold a field goal attempt here for South Florida.
Benjamin Williams. He's going to get close to the 5 before he's brought down. We'll bring up second down and goal.
Benjamin Williams.
And that's going to do it for the first quarter. Mistakes have been the Achilles heel of Central Florida.
It really has. When they had opportunities, they've taken advantage of it. But again, too many mistakes.
So the Bulls on top and looking to score again. They're on top 12-7. Second quarter coming up. Throwing. South Florida on top 12-7. Central Florida has been its own worst enemy. As you take a look at the first quarter stats, the two glaring turnovers, and then of course you tack on that safety in the end zone, and it's been a disaster for the Knights. They should be happy they're only down 12.
Well, I think they're very fortunate they are. It's going to be interesting how this series unfolds for South Florida.
Now the Bulls on second down and goal. Growth, he's going to keep trying to find the end zone on that right side. Did he get there? Yes, he did. Touchdown. His third rushing touchdown of the season. And South Florida capitalizes on another Central Florida turnover.
This is going to be a huge coaching job now for Central Florida, because those players are a little demoralized, obviously. And I think the thing now is you've got to keep them in the game. You can't get it all back in one play, but you've got to protect the football. You've got to not shoot yourself in the foot. And that's what Central Florida has done this entire first quarter.
Alvarado for the extra point. And they're going to review this play. Apparently, there's some questions if Grothy maybe were down with his knee before he got in.
I don't have. Yeah, well, it looks like I think he gets in. You know, it looks like he goes over the flag, and let's see with the knee. The knee's up. Great effort by Grothy. It's a little bit iffy. The knee was down, but was the ball across the plane?
That's a Conference USA officiating crew. Gil Geltke is the referee. Taking a look at its second review of the day. The last time they reviewed, it was on the safety play, which the call on the field stood. It was a safety. A Smith was not able to get out of the end zone. Now the question is, was Grothy down with that right knee before the ball crossed the plane?
I believe it's going to be a touchdown.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. Touchdown.
Well, I think the ruling was, again, the ball was across the plane before the knee touched, and looks like a good call by the officials and a good call, or good review from the booth.
And the extra point for Alvarado.
The kick is good.
So it's 19-7 South Florida.
Your USF ball.
And the crowd here at Raymond James Stadium, pleased as punch right.
Assistant coaches Donna Holyman and Randy
Well, George O'Leary must be spinning down there because his team has given up 10 points because of turnovers.
Well, they have, and it's not a George O'Leary turnover. Again, a mistake by the on the punt return team, special teams. And just a great break on the football by Mike Jenkins. And again, speed of the South Florida defense. It's hard to simulate that in practice. And you don't see it that much on the practice field. They're seeing it today from the South Florida Bulls.
And honestly, South Florida hasn't been all that sharp either. I mean, we can look to about two or three passes that probably should have been caught. But when Central Florida is just giving them opportunities, it's hard not to take advantage.
I don't think Grothy's numbers are all that great, but
no,
he's had
not.
Some huge plays that have been dropped.
Grothy 6, 27 rushing, and he's only completed 4 of 10 pass attempts. But again, Central Florida with a lot of mistakes. All right, let's go to the studio and Mike.
Well, Colt McCoy doesn't take him long. First play from scrimmage. Finds Jordan Shipley. He had 324 passing last week and 10 touchdowns, 10 interceptions, now 11 touchdowns. He takes to the house, 7-0 Texas on top of Iowa State.
The Scarlet Knights kicking game being very special as they block the kick. It goes down on the 1. Mike Hart takes it in from the 1.
Tied at 14.
All right, gentlemen, thank you very much. New quarterback in the game for Central Florida. It's Michael Greco, and he's going to keep trying to cut the corner on the left side. He's drug out of bounds.
Michael Greco is really an outstanding talent. Probably he's really a good runner. He's a 4'4", 4'5", guy. He's got outstanding size and can really run the football.
South Florida, in talking with their defensive coordinator, Wally Burnham, said they practiced this week expecting to see both guys, both Israel and Greco.
Right, they're two different styles of quarterback. Now, Greco probably more of a runner than Israel.
This is the 4th game of the season for Greco. Hands off here. And it's Kevin Smith.
Hand off to number 24, Kevin Smith.
Wally Burnham, the defensive coordinator, now in his 8th year at South Florida. But 40 years in the business. He's a linebacking guru. Of course, an assistant head coach at South Carolina in the 90s. And before that, an assistant under Bobby Bowden in Tallahassee.
I first met Wally Burnham in Tallahassee as Coach Bowden's assistant. Great football coach and just loves coaching football. He is what a football coach should be. That's Wally Burnham.
He's kind of a throwback.
He is a throwback.
This place is getting loud. 3rd down and 5. I'm gonna whistle this play dead as penalty flags come in. And South Florida thinks that the Knights moved up front.
I believe it's a procedure penalty against Central Florida. Again, you have a new quarterback, a little new cadence, new rhythm.
There is no delay of game. UCF called timeout before the 25-second clock ran out. Timeout, UCF.
So the Knights get a little bit of a break. There's Jim Leavitt. He's upset with that.
Well, they had, again, the 25-second clock running down. The quarterback apparently wasn't aware of it, and the timeout was called by the coach from the bench, which you can do that now, and again, to save the penalty. They didn't want the 5-yard penalty.
Well, college football on ESPNU continues later today as the Connecticut Huskies, undefeated on the year, take on Cedric Pierman and the Virginia Cavaliers. Saturday afternoon college football presented by Allstate on ESPNU coming up at 3:30 Eastern time. We're at Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida. He's Larry Coker. I'm Clay Matford. We've got the number 5 team in the country, the South Florida Bulls, on their home turf, trying to take care of in-state rival Central Florida. So far, so good for South Florida. On top, 19-7. A big 3rd down coming up here if they'll ever get that play underway. But another penalty flag.
Number 87 of the offense. 5 yards. It remains 3rd down.
That's senior wide receiver Sergio Joaquim, who's called for the false start.
Again, they just need to settle down and keep their poise. 3rd down 10 is a lot tougher than 3rd down and 5. And they don't need any tougher situations than they have already.
This defense for South Florida has been so good today so far. Big third down play. Close snap, Israel. Down. Another sack for Selvey. This guy is unbelievable. His second sack today. He now has 12 and a half on the year, which leads the country.
It reminds me a little bit of Javon Curse, a great player from Southwest Florida. He's got a great first step. He's not big, but look at his speed. And the way he can adjust. Nice, nice adjustment by Selvey.
Marcus Edwards back to receive the punt for the Rebels.
This guy's a factor. You'll see him on Sundays.
Blake clinging to punt from his own goal line. Fair catch called for at midfield by Edwards. And again, good field position for Grothy and South Florida. Well, Selvey continues to put up big numbers from that right defensive end position. You can see 18 career sacks now. He was very uncomfortable last year as a freshman. In fact, he had to take medicine to settle his stomach down before every game. But now he just makes opposing quarterbacks nervous.
Central Florida would like to give him some medicine now and settle him down, because this guy, he's special. He's a special player. And Wally Burns doing a good job giving him some schemes to allow him to come free.
Grothy wants to throw on first down. Wow, that was almost picked off. Almost intercepted by John L. Neal. Trying to get it out to Carlton Mitchell.
Again, really nice break by Neal.
Well, you talked about the schemes that Burnham has for that defensive front, but how about Dan McCarney coming over from Iowa State? He's coaching that defensive line now, and a lot of people, especially in Iowa, think that maybe he should have kept his job, but Iowa State's loss is South Florida's game.
Yeah, he's an outstanding football coach, and he's been around.
And this pass is incomplete. Grothy has thrown the long ball quite a bit here today. That was intended for Jesse Hester Jr., son of former Florida State great Jesse Hester.
Yeah, outstanding receiver. I think the thing with Dan McCarney, Dan really – and he had Selvey on an underneath move and really allowed his speed to take over to get to the quarterback. And you'll see him move around quite a bit. Selvey's going to be put in some different positions to allow him to put pressure on the quarterback. Jesse Hester Jr., yes, his father was a great, great wide receiver for Florida, the Florida State Seminoles.
Third and 10. Grothy, pressured and sacked. Down at the 37-yard line.
You're seeing some good things from Central Florida, but the consistency's got to be there. They can't have the turnovers, the safety, the negative plays, and those type things. But as you can see, that's a great defensive stop for the Central Florida defense.
That's Antonio Wallace, number 44, who made the sack. And so Central Florida will get the football back.
Joe Burnett.
Standing back at the 19-yard line. He calls for the fair catch. Did let it bounce. Got a lucky bounce right into his breadbasket. And so the Knights will have it again when we come back. All right, when we come back, another round of Bull or No Bull. We get another student here from South Florida to help us out. Don't go away. Bulls, and let's bring in Christina Fabris from the South Florida volleyball team to help us play another round of Bull or No Bull. Okay, Christina, we're ready.
All right, question one. The University of South Florida offers just under 120 academic programs.
I'll say No Bull.
It's actually Bull. USF offers 217 degree programs at the undergraduate, graduate, specialty, and doctoral levels, including the Doctor of Medicine.
Christina, I'm Larry Coker, and that's exactly what I said. I knew that was Bull.
Oh, you do it, eh?
Tell you what, this Bull defense is no Bull. There's another good stop on Kevin Smith. They said they had to stop that running game, and so far they have Mom Premier on the tackle. All right, Christina, what's question number two?
All right, question number two. Kelly Ripa from TV's Live with Regis and Kelly is a graduate of USF.
I'll say no Bull.
Actually, it's
wait,
Bull.
Wait, hang on, Christina.
My bad.
We got two people
wait
up here.
Oh,
that's,
okay.
That's Bull. That's Bull.
That you cheated, though. You already knew.
That's twice now you've gotten a break.
Christina and I are on the same team.
Oh, okay. Perfect. Okay, so it's actually Kelly's husband, Mark Consuelos, of the soap opera All My Children is a USF graduate, as is St. Louis Cardinals manager Tony La Russa.
I didn't know Tony La Russa.
Tony La Russa, great manager.
Yes.
All right, question number three, Christine, and wait for both of us to answer because I don't want to give Larry any more opportunities.
I know,
right.
Exactly. I'm helping him out too much. Right. All right. Besides football, Coach Leavitt has also coached tennis at the collegiate level. Bull or no bull?
I'm going to say bull.
I'm going to say bull on that one also.
All right, you're correct.
Yay.
Coach Leavitt was the track and field coach at Morningside College in Sioux City, Iowa, for three seasons, coaching 5 All-Americans and winning 13 conference titles. He also was the defensive coordinator for the football team.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
Very good, Christina. Thank you very much, and good luck with your volleyball career.
Thank you very much.
Christina Fabris, a senior here at South Florida, as I don't even know what the score is now, bull or no bull.
I know this. I didn't know Leavitt could do all that stuff. That's pretty impressive.
Pretty talented guy. Baseball player.
You've been a pretty talented coach here at South Florida. I know that. He has a great passion for the game. Coaches with a great intensity and great energy. And he is a football guy.
Boy, South Florida has done well defensively. Did they stop Central Florida enough here where it's not a first down? Yes, they did. They are short. So a fourth and inches coming up here for the Knights.
Again, I'm sure the Central Florida faithful would love to see the Knights go for this, but still early in the game. There's a lot of game left, and again, Central Florida's not behind that much. A touchdown puts them right back in this football game. Right now, they need a great protection, great punt, great coverage.
Blake Klingon will punt. Marcus Edwards is back at his own 35-yard line.
They have one. This might be a great time for a fake punt, but I don't think you'll see that from George O'Leary on this play.
Here it is. And they got it. You were right, Coach. They were at least thinking about it,
right,
and they executed it very well.
A really nice execution, a power play up the middle. And again, it's very short, only less than a yard.
Stephen Baker, number 14, is the player who carried the football and got the first down.
Nice power blocking up front, and a good fake by the punter. You can see the block. Oh, great job. Great job by the special teams from Central Florida.
There's Baker, number 14. He's the player who got the needed yardage. They've got it at the 35, first and 10. Greco's still out there at quarterback. Play fake. Steps out of a tackle. Throws it downfield to a wide open man. Caught at the 50, to the 30. And Kevin Smith is out of bounds at the 23-yard line. A huge play, Greco to Smith.
It's a great job by Greco staying alive. He beats the rush. And you can see a little different style of quarterback. Got excellent feet. Makes the defensive end miss him. Stays outside contained. You can see it here. Great job by Greco. And now they leave coverage. Wide open is Smith. Outstanding run.
43-yard pickup for Kevin Smith. And so much has been made of his running ability in this offense this year, but that was a pretty good receiving play. This time Smith has nowhere to go. Barely gets back to the line of scrimmage, if he did at all.
Well, this is, again, a big drive for Central Florida. And we'll remember that fake punt that they were successful on if they go ahead and finish this drive off and score a touchdown, because that was a huge play and really a gutsy call by George O'Leary.
Central Florida needs points on this drive.
They're going to have to make some plays in the passing game, and they haven't been able to do that consistently yet.
Greco hands off. It's Smith again. Penalty flag down on the far side of the field.
Carry by number 21, Curtis France.
France is actually on that last carry, and he has had a handful of carries this season.
Flag on the play.
actually a senior. Offside. Here's the call.
Number 95, lined up in the neutral zone on the defense. 5 yards, remains second down.
And it's Selvey called for the offside.
Now, Selvey lined up in the neutral zone, and again, normally you check one another out and don't allow that to happen. Both defensive ends check inside, and Selvey's got great get-off. He doesn't need to line up in the neutral zone, believe me.
Smith is in the backfield. Second down and 7. Flares it out to Smith, makes the catch. And behind that screen, can't find a seam to run. And Bruce Premier, the weak side linebacker, makes the tackle. And it's going to bring up third down and fairly long again here from Central Florida.
South Florida has such great speed, and again, they don't stay blocked very long. They get off blocks very well, they run to the football very well, and they tackle extremely well. So, you know, again, the slow developing plays like that are very difficult to execute.
Mont Premier, originally a backup to Moffitt at middle linebacker, but he's earned the starting spot at weak side, made a big play there to force a third and 10. And today, Central Florida just 1 for 4 on third down conversions. And again, they need points on this drive, and they would like 6 instead of 3. Greco chased. Directing traffic. Now he has to run. Will not get the first down. Jarrett Bowie, the left defensive end, finally tracked him down.
Well, the crowd's going boo, but not for chastising. It's for Bowie. And again, good job by Greco avoiding the rush, but still short of the first down. Nice job on the rush. Probably a little bit of a hold. And again, South Florida defense converges pretty well and stops Greco short of the first down.
Michael Torres coming on to attempt a 35-yard attempt. And it is good. So the fifth-year senior Torres pulls Central Florida to within 9. Let's check in with Mike.
And we go to Durham. Tyrod Taylor, Virginia Tech's quarterback, left the game with an ankle. Sean Glennon back in for the Hokies. But it's Kenny Lewis Jr. taking over here. 5 yards, touchdown, Hokies. 20-7, Virginia Tech on top. Mike Teal, we talked about the INT. Well, here's the touchdown to Kenny Britt. He takes it in. 21-14, Rutgers back on top in the dome. Clay?
Okay, thank you very much. We talked about South Florida's next meeting will be with Rutgers on the road in New Jersey.
And they got some tough games coming up.
Yeah, they do.
And I think, but they're all winnable. South Florida has a very good football team. They're all winnable. And I think, as you can see, the remaining schedule at Rutgers is going to be tough. Connecticut's a little bit of a surprise team. They're an undefeated team. They're playing Virginia today. So that'll be interesting to see how that the outcome of that game. Cincinnati, obviously. So it's going to be, there's some tough games coming up.
But certainly, I think the South Florida team has the confidence right now where they feel that every game is winnable.
Well, they really do. And I think Jim Leavitt and the staff have given them that, and they've been successful. And they believe they're going to, they literally are. I know it's coach talk, but this one game at a time thing, that's where they really sold on that. But they believe they can win every football game.
This is going to roll into the end zone. It gets by Jerome Murphy. And it'll be a touchback, and South Florida will have it first down at 10 at the 20. Now, there have been some critics. Jimmy Johnson, a guy who you used to work for, among them, who have said that South Florida really doesn't deserve this top 5 ranking. Your thoughts?
Well, I think this. I know, you know, as long as you keep winning, you're going to move up in the rankings. If you're undefeated, you're going to move up. I really feel about like Jim Leavitt does. Don't know if they deserve it or not, but they do know this, that 5 Saturdays, they were better than these previous 5 teams that they played. And I think that's the approach they're trying to take. They win all the games. They're going to get the rankings.
Grothy out of the shotgun, throws it into the flat to the receiver. It is caught by Bogan. And very little gain on that play.
Again, good pursuit by the Central Florida defense. They're really chasing the ball well. And nice job tackling in the open field.
Actually, no gain as the middle linebacker, Chance Henderson, 54, made the tackle. He leads the team in tackles for loss. Got a lot of playing time as a true freshman last year, now even more as a sophomore, and a regular starter for the Knights. So second down and 10 coming up now.
Play being called from the South Florida bench.
Grothy throws on the run. It is caught by Williams. He's got enough for the first down and more. And he is deadly when he gets in space. Out to the 45. They'll mark it down at the 46-yard line. A gain of 26 on the play.
This play is very similar to the one that Kevin Smith caught from the previous series for Central Florida. Again, a little scramble, nice easy touch, and really a good finish by Williams. Again, that's what Grothy gives. He's so much more effective when he's out of the pocket rather than inside the pocket.
And he has been very good with his legs here the last few weeks.
Well, I think that's his forte. He's a very accurate passer, but very difficult to contain.
On first and 10, we'll play fake. Grothy going down the middle of the field. Again, he had a receiver in stride, and Torres Johnson wants a penalty flag, none thrown.
Well, I don't think that was a penalty. I think it's a good no call by the official. You see what that South Florida is trying to play fake on first down and try to hit the big play. They've been close. They've had some drops. Again, probably not a great throw by Grothy that time, and really a good no call by the official.
You know, that's probably the first pass where it was Grothy instead of the receiver, and that's the reason the connection didn't happen.
That's exactly right. The rest of the passes we've seen have been drops that were deep passes. That was just a poor throw.
Grothy will give it to Ford this time. And we've got a third and long coming up.
Mike Ford.
This is what Matt Grothy has done today. And again, his feet get him out of a lot of trouble.
He's out of trouble here. Obviously, watch the throw. And great throw on the move. And again, also a great catch here by Taurus Johnson.
This is
a touchdown. You know, good job protecting the football, getting in the end zone.
Third and 8. Let's see what Grothy can do here. Out of the shotgun, sets up to throw. Has time, gets rid of it. And again, it was intended for Johnson. And again, the pass too high. And South Florida will have to punt. Grothy was hit pretty hard behind the play, but he gets up and he's going to walk off.
Now walking off a little gingerly, he got a pretty good shot and really good coverage by the Central Florida defense. And I think I see a little frustration on South Florida's team. We've had some opportunities, some overthrows. That was good coverage. And again, when you have opportunities to make plays, you've got to take advantage of those opportunities.
Joe Burnett, Central Florida's all-time leader in punt return yards. He set that record last week. He's back, standing at his own 10. He's got a little room, but it closes quickly, and he's dropped at the 15. George O'Leary and the Central Florida Knights have some work to do. They're down 19-10. Well, the keys for Central Florida coming into this game, Kevin Smith has to have a good game. There you see his numbers. They also needed consistent quarterback play, which they haven't really gotten, and no turnovers, which we know
exactly
hasn't
right.
happened.
Kevin Smith wanted carries, and his coach told him about he'd give him a carry for every ounce of Gatorade he drinks. He's had three 12-ounce bottles today, so 36 carries is in his future.
Greco, low snap, flares it out, got it to Smith, and now Smith is toppled at the 15-yard line. Maybe they'll mark it at the 14, which would be a loss of a yard. And South Florida's done a great job of him.
They've done really a good job, and it doesn't surprise me because they have such great speed. And they're an outstanding defensive football team. And
here's Wally Burnham.
Yeah, Wally Burnham's been around. He's a good football coach and really knows what he's doing. And he's a total football coach. Scholastically, kids go to school, they do the right things.
Coming up in 4.5 minutes to go before half. Central Florida has not been good offensively, but they're still in the game. Greco on the run, had nowhere to go with it but the sidelines. All right, let's go to Mike Gleason.
And we take you to the big house. Mike Hart strikes again. Goes over 1,000 on the year. This is his second touchdown, giving him 12 rushing touchdowns on the year. Michigan in control 24-7 over Purdue. Coming up on the SportsCenter U halftime report, Rutgers tries to bounce back. They're playing from behind with the lead now against Syracuse. Texas still looking for that first conference win. Illinois knocks out Penn State. Wisconsin, now they struggle with Iowa. It's all coming up at halftime, Clay.
Okay, we'll look forward to it, guys. We appreciate it. Mike and Steve in the studio today. They'll get you updated at the half. We've got 4:28 to go before the break. South Florida on top. But Central Florida is in this one in spite of their own mistakes. And there was almost another one. That was intended for Rocky Ross, and it was almost picked off by Ryan Gilliam.
That's a good break by Gilliam. The thing that's tough about this also, it's going to be short of a first down, even if they make this catch, but nice break by Gilliam. Very fortunate the ball not intercepted.
Marcus Edwards to receive the punt for the Bulls.
Edwards will return this punt. He's at the 50. Klingon is in his own end zone. End over end kick.
Should get great field position here.
Edwards starts it back. Gets into Central Florida territory, but not very far. Well, college football on ESPNU continues later tonight with two games. First at 7 Eastern. Catch a Big East showdown as Brian Brohm leads the Louisville Cardinals against the number 15 Cincinnati Bearcats, another undefeated team in the Big East. Then at 10 Eastern, the Florida A&M Rattlers face the South Carolina State Bulldogs. College football primetime presented by Citi on ESPNU. South Florida will host Cincinnati November 3rd. You take a look at Louisville winning the last four meetings in that rivalry. Brophy will keep it himself and gets inside the 45 down at the 44-yard line. That's a gain of 5 on the play. And you know the South Florida program would love to be undefeated when they get a chance at Cincinnati on November 3rd. And it's very possible both teams could be undefeated.
It'll be very interesting if it is. It's definitely possible for both teams to be undefeated. And there's going to be some good football left in the season. So still a lot of undefeated teams left.
It's Ford again. And he's built Ford tough. I had to use it. Inside the 35-yard line, it's a pickup of a first down for Ford.
Tackle by number 19, Joe Burnett.
He's the cousin of South Florida receiver Amari Jackson.
What's a nice cut by Ford, and again a great finish by Ford. And Central Florida's got to stop him short again. The first down. This is a huge drive. Central Florida's still in this football game, but they need to really stiffen their defense right here.
It's Ford again, and he's got another first down. Now Ford originally signed on to play at Alabama, but didn't have the grades. He got them straightened out, then chose to come to South Florida. Bulls are glad to have him.
Well, very glad to have him. I think, of course, his family's from this area. Great to have an opportunity for your family to see you play. And I think right now, I think you see the Central Florida defense getting a little bit tired, and I think South Florida's taking advantage of that.
36 yards and a touchdown for Ford today. Got him again here, and he'll pick up 2.
Well, like Greg Gregory, the offensive coordinator for South Florida, said, you know, we're not just a spread team. We're also a tight zone team. We're a physical attacking team. Now they've got a tight end in the football game, and I think it makes a huge difference as far as getting your defense prepared to play, but also being able to use some power football to run the football at, in this case, Central Florida.
Tight end number 9, Cedric Hill, is in the game here.
Much improved blocker, by the way.
Fake the inside handoff. Brophy will take it to the outside. Gets to the 15-yard line. Well short of the first down. And it'll bring up a 3rd and about 3 on the play.
Chance Henderson,
the middle linebacker, made the tackle.
Again, again, they don't mind for Grothy to carry the football. You know, they feel like he's a very durable runner, and that's one of the best parts of their football game was with Grothy carrying the football as a runner.
He was the leading rusher last year, and it's likely to be the same case again this year. South Florida 1-for-8 on third down conversions today. Looking for it here. Turns and gives to Jamar Taylor, and he didn't get it. In fact, maybe didn't even get back to the original line of scrimmage.
No, he didn't get back to the line of scrimmage again. They ran the tight zone play, but really good penetration, good defense by the Central Florida Knights.
So they'll bring in Alvarado here to attempt the field goal. And Central Florida will call a timeout and let Alvarado think about it a little bit here. Now for up-to-the-minute news from everything that is college sports, log on to ESPNU.com. This online service is a gateway to the best in college sports content from ESPN, combining the latest news, scores, features, video highlights, podcasts, and much more. If you don't have ESPNU, be sure to log on to ESPNU.com and type in your zip code at the top of the page or call your local cable operator or satellite provider. ESPNU.com, log on today. This will be a 33-yard attempt for Alvarado. We've mentioned that it's been a tough year for him.
Has been a tough year, and again, they beat Auburn at Auburn, but several missed field goals, but they were still able to win that football game. And I think this is going to be good for Central Florida. Make this kicker beat us, and so it's going to be a tough situation for South Florida.
Alvarado's already made a 34-yarder today. This is from 33. Out of the hold of Anthony Severino. And the kick is good. So Alvarado, the second field goal made today, and that increases South Florida's lead to 22-10.
That's huge because he's going to have to win football games for him as these undefeated teams come in, as the season progresses. It's going to come down. Alvarado's going to have to do the job. He looks very comfortable today and looks very confident. So whatever problems he had against Auburn, he seems to have those things corrected.
Alvarado is the guy who actually holds the Big East record for the longest field goal. He's got a 56-yarder in his career that came last season against Syracuse. And like you said, he's had some rough spots this year, but maybe he's starting to work those out.
You ought to look at a 56-yard field goal from field level. It looks like it's about 4 miles away. That's an impressive kick at 56 yards. Not a high percentage kick, but an impressive kick.
Well, that drive, 7 plays, 33 yards in 2 minutes and 42 seconds. And again, it started with good field position, and it seems like South Florida has either had good field position to start a drive or they've taken over because of a turnover.
No doubt about it. The field position has been in their favor almost the entire half, and except after the fake punt, and then Central Florida was able to move the football.
This is Curtis Francis from inside the 5-yard line. Out over the 20, changes directions, and is stood up short of the 30. And a host of tacklers there for the Bulls, leading the way is Rhett Hamrick.
21, Curtis Francis on the return.
It's a 27-yard return. All right, in the Bull or no Bull game, I'm sure you're all concerned about this running score. You're on top 4-3.
Well, I did have a little help, but I'll take all the help I can get.
But we have two quarters to go. We'll have another match in the third quarter and one more in the fourth. So I've got time. I'm sure you're worried. Kyle Israel back at quarterback. And he's out of the gun on first down, looking to throw. Here comes that pressure, Selvey on his backside. And even though the pressure didn't even get close to Israel, you get the sense that he feels it.
No doubt he feels the pressure. And I tell you, Michael Jenkins, they're not getting any push on these corners at all. They're setting down on these routes, and they're going to have to run some verticals down the field because I guarantee you, Mike Jenkins that time sat on top of the route. Had it been a good throw, might have been an interception.
Kamar Aiken was the intended receiver that last time. Second and 10. Crowd again being heard from. Sellout here at Raymond James Stadium. Israel nowhere near the intended receiver, Rocky Ross. Israel Nate Allen, the free safety, was in on the coverage. Israel has not looked sharp.
Not at all. I think advantage now, certainly, with South Florida, because this is the type of game they wanted Central Florida to have to play, where you have to throw the ball to get back in the game or win the football game. And this is an advantage for the South Florida Bulls.
Israel was pulled in the second half last week for one series, but things didn't fare any better for Michael Greco, and he was brought back in. A tough day for Israel. Again, low snap. Pressure, and he sacked again. And I think it was Selby who knocked him down at first. Klebert cleaned him up, but they may give at least half a sack to Selby.
I'm sure they would. If I was his coach, I'd give him half a sack. He's putting a lot of pressure on the quarterback. And again, I think they brought Israel back in because he's maybe a better passer, but again, great pressure there. And I don't know if Selby got the sack there, but that was good, certainly good pressure.
98, Aaron Harris was probably the guy who did the most damage.
Yeah, I think Aaron Harris will want that sack.
South Florida has called a timeout.
Well, South Florida has two timeouts left. They're going to get good field position probably. Over a minute to go. That's a long time in college football with the clock stopping on every first down.
College football on ESPNU continues tomorrow afternoon as the Benedict Tigers take on the Kentucky State Thoroughbreds. SIAC college football on ESPNU tomorrow at 2:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com.
Marcus Edwards back to receive the punt for the ball.
Blake Klingon. Another punt. And Marcus Edwards calling for the fair catch at the 31. Coach, what are you doing here if you're South Florida with a minute and 3 left on the clock? Are you happy with this lead, or are you going to try and tack some more on?
I think you're happy with this lead, but you've got a pretty good field position. I think you attack their defense. I think you've had some opportunities to make some big plays. You've had some drops. I think you've got timeouts left. I don't think the number 5 team in the country is going to sit on the football here. I think they've got to attack.
Brophy on first down, over the middle. Caught by Johnson, and he's got enough for the first down. The clock continues to roll after they move the chains.
Back away, number 54, Chance Henderson.
Brophy with that pass. Right on the numbers to Johnson.
They're in a no-huddle, 2-minute drill, and again, that's really a nice, the personality that South Florida has anyway. And
another catch, this time Benjamin Williams out of the backfield. Short of the first down, it's a 9-yard gain, and now another timeout call.
I think it was a really nice catch, but again, not a good throw by Grothy. The ball was thrown behind him. If he put it in front of the receiver, he's probably going to be able to get out of bounds or at least make a first down to stop the clock.
So South Florida wants another timeout, and each team has one left here before the half.
I think they would like to save that one timeout for possibly a field goal or a position where they might need it down in the red zone area. Again, South Florida is going to try to get points here. They want points. They're not going to sit on this lead, and they shouldn't.
Second down and 2 coming up. And with 42 seconds on the clock, there's certainly plenty of time given the field position.
And no doubt about it. And clock again in college football stops on first downs.
Brophy. He's going to try to run for the first down. He's pulled from behind, but I think he got it.
Brophy on the carry. Back by number 91,
Leger Duzabel. Leger Duzabel on the tackle.
That
number 91.
For another.
He's playing in his hometown today. In fact, the only member of Central Florida who hails from Tampa. Brophy on first down. Got away. Inside the 35, inside the 30, still on his feet, and down at the 19-yard line. finally Chance Henderson, the middle linebacker, got him from behind. 18 seconds to go, and the Bulls now are probably starting to think six instead of three.
Like they are. They have a lot of downs left, but they don't have a lot of time left.
And Grothy will spike it to stop the clock with 15 seconds to go.
They still have that one timeout. They still have opportunities for maybe three plays.
Certainly, they're going to have to use the sidelines.
They're going to have to use the sidelines or maybe use the one timeout. Or, of course, incompletions will stop the clock, but they probably need to go to the end zone. Here, a nice job by Grothy. I thought he was going to try to get out of bounds here, but, again, a nice move. And even though he stays in play, he's got him in great position for at least for a field goal.
They split the running back out, Williams, so it's a five-receiver set. Grothy has a lot of field in front of him. Still wants to throw. Now he can't, but he got the first down, and more importantly, he got out of bounds with 7 seconds to go.
Again, he has a lot of downs, but not much time. He has 7 seconds. May have a time for a play, and then the field goal may put the field goal unit in now. I think they'll probably maybe try to go to the end zone for one play.
What do you do?
Well, I do. I go to the end zone for one play, and then I kick the field goal.
Looks like you and Jim Leavitt are on the same page. Grothy is still out there. 8 for 19, 102 yards passing, but he's been most impressive on the ground.
Quarterback Grothy needs to know that time's not on his side here. He can't really scramble here. He scrambles here. He scrambles here, then time's going to run out on. I think they're going to discuss this. They may want to go for the field goal here. I think they do want points. Again, you'd like to see him have an opportunity to go for the football. One opportunity.
Central Florida has called a timeout, which probably actually benefits the Bulls here. They get a little more time to think about exactly how they're going to use their 7 seconds.
Well, that's exactly right. And again, I think Central Florida wanted South Florida to think about it a little bit. Plus, let them know that, hey, time is on our sides. We can hold. Make him scramble fine. Just tackle him short of the end zone.
Who makes the call here? Is it the offensive coordinator Greg Gregory, or does Jim Leavitt make the call?
Well, I think Greg Gregory will make the call, but I think that whether the field goal or to go for the play, I think will be Jim Leavitt's call.
Grothy. Time winding down. We'll take a crack at the end zone. Has it caught? What a catch by Johnson. With 2 seconds on the clock.
I felt like Grothy was going to hold the ball a little bit too long, but again, he held it just right for the touchdown. That's a little bit of an iffy call because sometimes you can lose time run out, but they did have one timeout left.
First touchdown catch of the year for Torres Johnson, and it's a big one just before the half. Alvarado on for the extra point. And it's 29-10 South Florida.
Well, again, that's a huge play and a big nail in the coffin of Central Florida. You know, they haven't done things to win the football game. Central Florida hasn't. And, again, look at the protection here. Great protection. Great throw by Grothy. Just getting the ball up, and he's going to catch it. His receiver's going to catch it, or nobody's going to catch it. Great move.
We talked about Moxie, and Grothy has it.
I think he's got moxie. He's got a lot of confidence, and he just really believes in himself and believes in what he can do. But more importantly, his coaches believe in him, and these players believe in him, his teammates.
Well, it's going to be a demoralizing play for Central Florida to take another blow right before the half.
Well, it is, and what a big play for Torres Johnson. What a first touchdown pass, and what a huge time to have that. Again, everybody in this field probably knows who he is. He's got teammates that he's played against and from other schools in this area. Really nice play by Torres Johnson.
South Florida with wins over Elon, 17th-ranked Auburn, North Carolina, 15th-ranked West Virginia, last week over Florida Atlantic. Trying to stay undefeated here today by taking care of their I-4 rival, Central Florida. And through the first half, they are doing just that. It is 29-10 Bulls. Of course, Central Florida didn't help themselves at all in that first half. A lot of mistakes.
Right. They have really, Central Florida hasn't done things they need to do to win the football game.
Sports Center, you at the half. Mike Gleason and Steve Israel coming up.
All right, thank you, Clay, and welcome to the SportsCenter U Halftime Report. Along with Steve Israel, I'm Mike Gleason. As always, great to have you with us. You know, we were talking during the broadcast there that over the last two or three years, you can see the athleticism has really improved at South Florida, but the guy that really makes the offense tick is their leader, the quarterback, Matt Grothy.
He does more to make them tick. He makes them explode with his arm and with his running ability. The one thing that really stands out is how tough he is and how scrappy he is. You know, he had some drops early in the game, but you know what? He's showing that he can get the ball downfield. He has arm strength, but he's just so impressive in doing whatever it takes to make a play happen, and that's what you call a football player. You know, some quarterbacks are just pure quarteracks, and they're good, and they do a good job at Bryant Brohm and Matt Ryan, but this kid is a football player, Glee.
So South Florida goes from unranked to number five in the country, now with a big lead, and that's no bull.
Alongside Larry Coker, I'm Clay Matthick. We're at Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida, where the South Florida Bulls, ranked five in the country, played pretty well in the first half. They lead it 29-10, of course. A lot of Central Florida mistakes in that first half. Did not help the Knights' cause, and it seemed like at every opportunity the Bulls took advantage.
Well, the Bulls did, and again, they dropped some passes, which would have really blown this game open, but they've taken advantage of the turnovers, and really Central Florida has really not given themselves a chance to win. Here's a great TD right before half, obviously the touchdown pass to finish the half, and now 29-10 game, so really a good position for South Florida.
Here's our Oxy first half stats, and the three turnovers really stand off the page. And Kevin Smith was hoping to have a big day here, the nation's leading runner when it comes to yards per game, but just 49 on 16 carries in that first half. Of course, it's not his fault because Central Florida didn't have the ball a lot because they were turning it over.
Well, they didn't, and I tell you, the thing so impressive two things that stand out is Grothy and the defense of South Florida. And it really made it tough on any running back, especially Kevin Smith.
There's Grothy and his trademark mohawk. Grothy actually outrushing Kevin Smith in that first half. He had 68 yards on the ground to 49 for Smith.
Well, I think South Florida hasn't allowed a 100-yard rusher this year. And I think Central Florida knew for them to have an opportunity to win this game that Kevin Smith hadn't had a big game. And thus far, he hasn't been able to do that. And again, not all his fault.
We'll see what happens here in the second half. This is Torres to kick off here as South Florida will have it to start. And this will be a big opening series if the Bulls can put another touchdown on the board that's really going to take the wind out of Central Florida's sails. Torres Johnson and Jerome Murphy back. It's Murphy to return it. And he gets out of bounds at about the 35-yard line, so decent field position again for the Bulls.
Definitely decent field position, and this is a big series for both teams, but especially for Central Florida. They need to stop here. They haven't been able to switch ends in the field, and what I mean by that, they haven't been able to gain the advantage in field position. It's all been with South Florida. But first of all, they've got to protect the football, and that's going to be the key for Central Florida this second half.
You saw Grothy's numbers, 68 on the ground, 111 passing in the first half.
With a lot of drops.
We were talking with athletic director Doug Woolard during the halftime, and he thinks Grothy is throwing the ball better today than he has all season. Jamar Taylor on the carry on first down, a short pickup. But like you said, his receivers haven't helped him out at all.
Really haven't. He's moved around well. He's made some excellent throws on the move, and I know those receivers are very disappointed because you don't have that many opportunities during the course of a day to hit the home runs, to catch the touchdown balls. And they've had two or three of those opportunities that they haven't been able to finish the job.
Second and eight for Matt Grothy. First series of the second half. Grothy coming to the near side. On the run, threw it to the near sideline and incomplete.
Grothy's pass intended for number 30,
He sent Jamar Taylor, the intended receiver.
The Central Florida defense has just not been able to contain Grothy. He's been able to break contain almost any time he wants to, and really allows puts a lot of pressure on the Central Florida defense, especially the secondary.
Like you said, Central Florida needing a big stop here. They're going to try to do just that on third down. South Florida just 1 for 9 today on third down conversions, and they're looking at a 3rd and 8, so not ideal situation here for the Bulls.
Again, the play being called from the South Florida sideline.
Grothy going to the air, near sideline, has a man. Interference is going to be called. Trying to get it to Marcus Edwards. And Emery Allen, number 22, the nickelback, is going to be flagged here for pass interference.
Well, Emery Allen really never faced the quarterback. You can face guard in college football, but you can't interfere with the right of the receiver to catch the football.
10 yards, first down.
Grothy just gets the ball up in the air. You can see there, nice, a little push before he actually gets turned, and again, a good call by the official. In college football, it's a spot foul. Excuse me, it's a line of scrimmage foul. It's from the line of scrimmage. In professional football, that would have been marked down where the foul occurred.
So a big break for the Bulls on first down. They give it to Benjamin Williams. And he's had a tough go of it today on the ground. Not a lot for Williams today.
No, not a lot for Williams. Again, most of the offense from South Florida has been through growth. He's been able to move around and make plays. Not a lot of consistent runs from the South Florida offensive football team.
Gain of 2, 2nd down and 8.
So South Florida trying to take advantage of another Central Florida mistake. This time it was a penalty in the secondary. Now they've got it in Knights territory. 2nd down and 8 at the 45. Grothy checking his play at the line. And he's going to keep it. Look at him go. He's going to get enough for the first down. Big stiff arm inside the 30. And out of bounds at the 20-yard line. That is what Matt Grothy will do for him. He is only 6 feet tall, 213 pounds. Some have criticized him for maybe running too much at times. Other critics have said this guy's not tall enough. He's only 6 feet tall, but this guy's got a big heart. And here he picks up a key first down.
Oh, great blocking by the South Florida offensive line. Again, you like to see Grothy get out of bounds here. He doesn't have much room to go there, so just get out of bounds and save that hit for another day.
25-yard gain on the ground for Grothy.
He's nearing 100 yards rushing.
Grothy again. Ball comes loose, and it looks like the Bulls have recovered. Now, that's one thing you don't see happen very often. Grothy's pretty good with the football usually. Marcus Edwards, number 11, was Johnny on the spot there to get on that football.
And it's a good strip by Central Florida. Grothy a little bit lax carrying the football away from his body, and great job on the strip, and very fortunate there. Great effort by the offense to follow the football.
Caught. Ben Busby, the tight end, and he's got enough for the first down.
They don't use their tight ends a lot, but as I said earlier in the broadcast, this is a little different spread offense. They're more of a one-back team. They like to run the football, and they will use a tight end in the scheme. Nice quick fake, good block, excellent pass, and good finish by the tight end, Busby.
Busby, the sophomore out of Mobile, Alabama, he heads off to the sideline, and it's first and goal to go. Grothy has backs on either side, and he's going to do the inside handoff to Mike Ford, who already has a touchdown today. And the rookie picks ahead for maybe a couple of yards. He's down at the 6.
Real advantage here for South Florida. Again, a nice little trap play to Ford, and not a big game, but a nice positive game. And I think it's one thing that Greg Gregory, the offensive coordinator, said, running game, we need to have positive plays. That was a positive play.
2nd down, goal to go from the 6. Grothy wants to keep it himself. This time running out of room, steps out of a couple of tackles, and makes his way into the end zone. Unbelievable play by Matt Grothy. He was dead in the backfield a couple of times and somehow does a Houdini act and gets his way into the end zone. 100 yards on the ground today for Grothy, and his second touchdown coming on this play.
Well, again, he breaks two tackles on this play. Again, there's a third. I think the thing you see with Grothy, he's just another running back. They're actually playing with 12 men when they have him. He's a quarterback that can pass, can scramble, but also he becomes a running back and can run the football.
Delbert and Alvarado with the extra point. The kick is good. And the Bulls have opened this one up pretty good now. 26-point lead, 36-10. And Mohawk of Matt Grothy getting into the end zone on that last six-yard run. Grothy and the Bulls continue to take advantage of Central Florida mistakes. That last eight-play touchdown drive wouldn't have happened if it weren't for this play. Emory Allen called for pass interference. If he's a little smarter on that play, South Florida's forced to punt, but it didn't happen, and the Bulls take it into the end zone.
Well, that's a little bit the story of the day for Central Florida. The mistakes they've made, the penalty they made there, just kept things alive for South Florida.
Not a ton of penalties today, but you couple that with the three turnovers, it's a lot of Central Florida mistakes.
Well, also, and then the timing of penalties, sometimes those are the critical things, just the worst time possible for the drive for that pass penalty.
Curtis Francis will start this return. Penalty flag. Thought I saw a flag, no flag. Out over the 30, out at the 33-yard line. Now there is a penalty flag down.
Curtis Francis to tackle by number 40, Houston Hess.
Normally blocking the back when it's in that position.
100 yards of total offense for the game. This means you win. Take your tickets to Denny Kane's or Save On Furniture and receive a voucher for a free 6-inch Subway sandwich. Largest furniture selection, Kane's.
Apparently no flag.
Apparently no flag.
No penalty flag on the play. All right, so first and 10 here for Central Florida. Play action. And Israel's pass is incomplete. It was intended for Mike Merritt.
Pass intended for number 81.
And let's go to the studio.
Hey, Clay, Illinois rolling along, and then all of a sudden here come the Iowa Hawkeyes.
Yes, he finds Brandon Myers, the tight end. Justin Harrison, his first key is number one vertical. Myers was number one vertical.
Illinois down 10-6.
All right, guys, thank you. 36-10. South Florida, the number five team in the country. Got a good job here on their home field. Kevin Smith has had a tough day, just 49 yards rushing in the first half. Came into this game leading the nation with an average of 172 on the game. Defensive coordinator Wally Burnham for South Florida told us this week, we've got to key in on him. We've got to do a great job slowing him down, and they certainly have.
And they really have done that. He's a slasher. He's not a big home run hitter, so it's really a tough situation for Central Florida to be in. But he is a slashing runner, and Wally Berman's right. His defense has done a great job.
Third and eight. Israel threw it out. And Curtis Francis made the catch, but he's dropped for a loss of 4 yards on the play. In Central Florida, on their first series of the second half, is forced to kick. And it appears to make matters worse for the Knights that Kevin Smith is over on the sideline in pain.
It was a great break on the ball by Mike Jenkins. Really, his closing speed is unbelievable. It really attacks the football, number four, the corner for Central Florida, or South Florida.
Good punt by Klingon. Edwards dancing around back there, a short return. We'll call it 5 yards. Edwards, a 53-yard punt for Klingon. College football on ESPNU continues today as the Connecticut Huskies take on Cedric Pierman and the Virginia Cavaliers. That's a big game. Saturday afternoon college football presented by Allstate on ESPNU at 3:30 Eastern. Connecticut is undefeated on the year. Virginia having a good season. in the ACC. They want to get a non-conference win today at home.
Yeah, Connecticut, Virginia lost the first game. They've done extremely well after that. They're undefeated and got a pretty good streak going.
Grothy will make the play fake and throw it downfield. Has a man wide open at the 50-yard line. It's Carlton Mitchell. Mitchell got behind the defender in the secondary and made the catch.
That play is good for another goal.
Looks like he got 1 foot down. Really nice job by Mitchell. Again, Grothy just lays it up under a little bit of pressure. See? Yeah, definitely gets the foot down in bounds, has control. Big play by Mitchell.
32 yards on that pass play in Central Florida. Sees it in their territory again. The pass tipped and falls incomplete. Torres Johnson got a hand on it, couldn't pull it in.
I think you see South Florida still attacking, and I think they should. Again, there's a lot of football left, and you know where they are, the fifth-ranked team in the country. There's really no margin for error. They need to play well and maybe impress some of the pollsters around the country that won't see this game. All they will see will be a score, and I think they need to keep playing, and that's exactly what they're doing.
Well, let's be honest. A lot of coaches back in the old days were afraid to run up the score, but now you almost have to.
Yeah, it's part of the process now.
Grothy, this is where he's the most dangerous, and he's contained for the most part on that play. A 4-yard pickup. Jason Benson, free safety, made the tackle. Let's go to Mike Gleason.
And we head back down to the Orange Bowl play. Taylor Bennett, the quarterback for Georgia Tech, starting to hear some things, some rumblings, take some heat. You saw one touchdown run. Here he comes again. Just gets inside the pylon. Another touchdown. Tech on top, 14-7.
All right, guys, thank you very much. Georgia Tech on top of Miami. And there's a couple of teams that have had interesting years.
Well, both teams need a win.
Obviously,
it's a league game. It's in the division, and Georgia Tech, a very good team. Miami, I think, struggled a little bit at times. Both teams need to win today.
Now there's a penalty against South Florida. Illegal formation against the Bulls. Marks it back. Second down and 15. Grothy bouncing back there like a pinball. Stays on his feet. Got it off to midfield. What a catch by Cedric Hill, the tight end.
I really like Cedric Hill. He's really improved as a blocker, but he's really an outstanding receiver. Doesn't get many opportunities, but he keeps making catches like this. He'll get more opportunities. And probably a little ill-advised throw by Grothy, but when you have a little magic, you kind of make it happen.
How did Hill catch that?
Well, I think he just took it away from the linebacker, but really a great job by Hill. Should have been intercepted.
So third and 11 now as Grothy again makes something out of absolutely nothing. And it's a third and long situation. Not ideal, but at least got better field position here. And they're going to pick up the first down. How about that? Benjamin Williams may even get a touchdown. Now finally brought down deep in the secondary. A 31-yard play. Williams inside the 20-yard line. And here we go again, South Florida back in the Knights red zone.
Well, Central Florida defense is very tired now. They're getting no pressure on Grothy, and nice throw here to the running back, and Williams does a nice job. Again, they're going to have to get some pressure on Grothy. They're not able to do that now. They're a tired defensive football team, tired front.
Grothy goes back to the run game, and Williams is pulled down for a loss of about 5 yards on the play. You know, Coach,
30, Benjamin Williams.
I think they're getting pressure on Grothy, but they're just not able to finish him off.
Well, that's exactly right. They haven't been able to contain him when he scrambles. And, again, when he stayed in the pocket that time, very smart on his part. He stayed in the middle of his protection. Great job at the offensive line and allowed to get the football off.
How come we haven't heard his name mentioned a lot when you talk about the Heisman Trophy?
I haven't heard it mentioned at all.
Maybe
we should mention it today.
Grothy. Inside the 10-yard line, a catch there by Marcus Edwards, and he spins his way down at the 5.
The number 11, Marcus Edwards.
I'm not saying that he should be a favorite for the trophy, but certainly his name should be mentioned.
He definitely should be mentioned. Nice job here setting up and good protection. Again, just an outstanding throw. I think we've got growth, and normally you don't mention quarterbacks that are runners. Normally your quarterback mentioned for Heisman have a lot of passing yards. Maybe that's not fair, but I think Grothy is a complete player, probably a little better with his legs than he is as a passer.
Mike Ford. Again, the running backs for South Florida haven't had a ton of success today.
No, you don't see it. Again, Grothy with his legs. I guess Grothy, it counts. We've mentioned him for the Heisman. Does that count, Clay?
Yeah.
It counts one, right?
I don't know if anybody's listening to us, but we've said it.
Well, I think if he keeps winning, I think it's going to be a real key because he's the key for this South Florida football team offensively to keep on track. He's fun to watch.
Second and goal to go from the 7. Grothy wants to throw. Look into the end zone. Comes back to the other side. A man wide open. The tight end, Cedric Hill. He was the team's top receiving tight end last year, and he is again this year. That's his first touchdown of the season, and this game now is blown wide open.
Well, great job there. Just a little delay by Cedric Hill. I've seen this play several times. Syracuse, Paul Pasqualoni being the head coach of Syracuse, Donovan McNabb, the quarterback, and you can see that everything looks like it's going to the right, and here comes delay with the tight end. Here comes Cedric Hill across the field. Again, wide open. It's very tough to defend. You work on it a lot in practice, but it's hard to defend when it happens in the game.
43-10. And you know what? After this week, he might even be ranked higher than 5.
Well, depends on what happens 1 through 4. I mean, that's going to be the real key for South Florida.
All right, when we come back, we continue to play America's favorite game show, Bull or No Bull. We're going to learn more about this football team and this university when we come back. Cedric Hill with that last touchdown catch to open this game to a 43-10 score. South Florida at home today in front of a sellout crowd, impressing their fans and maybe continuing to impress the rest of the country.
Well, they'll need to do that because, again, South Florida, be it right, wrong, fair, they're going to have to, there's no margin for error. They can't lose, and they need to impress the pollsters around the country.
Central Florida has had a tough day. A lot of it's been their own fault. Curtis Francis at the goal line with this return. Steps over a couple of tacklers. And out of bounds, short of the 20. Let's go to the studio for an update with Mike.
Oxford, Mississippi, Ole Miss. Ben Jarvis, Green Ellis broke off a long one. Sets up this 4-yard touchdown by Seth Adams. And Ole Miss has come back to tie Alabama 17 apiece. Clay?
Okay, good game there.
Yeah, outstanding game. I tell you, those SEC teams, they're not a lot of fun to play because they can all play. They all have athletes. They can win any Saturday.
Yeah. Well, let's welcome in Jessica Lawson as we continue to play Bull or No Bull and get to a little more familiar with this team and this university. And Jessica, welcome in. You're a junior on the basketball team, we understand.
Yes, sir.
All right, Jessica, fire away.
USF had 4 former players go on to play on the Super Bowl teams.
I'm going to say no bull. And you say?
I'll say bull.
Kenyatta Jones and Scott McGrady played on the 2001 New England Patriots. Ryan Benjamin played for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers in 2002. And J.R. Reed played for the 2004 Philadelphia Eagles squad.
It was no bull.
No
wow.
Bull.
Wow. Good
right.
Job,
hey,
Jessica.
I think I've tied you.
You did. Yeah, I know you did.
All right, we've got time for one more before the kick here. Jessica, fire away.
In USF's first ever history football game in 1997 against Kentucky Westernland, the Bulls score 80 points.
80 points. I'm going to say no bull.
That's no bull.
The answer is no bull. USF beat Kentucky Westernland in an 80-3 in the program's first ever football game.
That was in 1997.
Yes.
All right, your last question.
Coach Jim Leavitt played tight end as a member of the University of Missouri football team.
A lot of Jim Leavitt questions today. I got to think about that. I can't remember what position he played.
I think that's Bull. I don't think he was a tight end.
I'm going to say no Bull. I think he was a tight end.
Answer is Bull. Coach Leavitt was a defensive back. He led the Tigers in tackles in 1977 and was second team All Big Eight.
No.
Dang, I think that puts you ahead of me again, Coach. Thank you, Jessica. Hold tight. We got a question for you.
Okay.
First down at 10 for Central Florida. They turn and go back to the running game and Kevin Smith, but like it has been all day, very tough running. All right, Jessica, how is the women's basketball team shaping up for this season?
I think that the women's basketball team is going to be very ready for this season. We're looking very good. I think that the men's football team, they stepped up the standards. They're showing us where the Bulls are ready to go, and us women's basketball team, we're ready to jump on board. We're ready to continue.
Now, you're back in your home state after being out at Cal for a while, aren't you?
Yes.
You happy to be back home?
Oh, it always feels good to come back home. It always feels good to come back home, especially coming into a great program. I'm just really excited.
Well, good luck to you this season, Jessica. And thanks for helping us out on our game show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
All right. Bye-bye. Kyle Israel dropped the football and jumped back on it, but this is going to bring up a third down and six situation. As Central Florida still unable to get any traction offensively.
Well, again, it's kind of been the day, the way it's been today for Central Florida. Had a lot of running room, could have run forever and just dropped the football, but he was able to fall back on it. But, again, not doing things that they need to do to give themselves a chance to score some points and maybe get back in this football game.
Central Florida just 1-for-8 on third down conversions today. Israel. Deep downfield, right sideline. A little bit too far for the intended receiver, but look out, a penalty flag comes in. And they may tag Mike Jenkins on this penalty. It is very seldom that Jenkins makes a mistake, but perhaps he's going to be called for interference here. And Jim Leavitt sees this penalty coming, and he's already arguing.
Yeah. Jim Leavitt is. I think he is saying Bull on that play. He didn't
number
like that
four
call.
Number four of the defense, 15 yards, first down.
Sergio Joaquin was the receiver that Israel almost hit on the run. And they get Jenkins on the penalty.
It's a good effort by Joaquin. A really good throw by Israel to get the ball out of his hand. It had a blitz on from South Florida and really put pressure on Israel. But he got a bit of the football, gave his receiver a chance. Those are things that you have to do. You got to break with a penalty.
I say that Jenkins very seldom makes that mistake. Why? Because he's probably got the best speed of anybody in the secondary, and he doesn't have to make up for it by making penalties.
No, the coverage was good.
Israel. Oh. Had a man wide open, and this time he overthrew him. Rabaczynski, the tight end, was wide open on the near sideline, and that's just how Central Florida's day has gone.
That's been their total day, just not making plays. And again, they're having to do things they really don't want to do, but have to do to get back in a football game. Wide, wide open, just a poor throw by Israel. Again, he's frustrated with that throw, and he should be. He'd love to have it back, but again, there's no do-overs in college football.
Israel now just 3 of 7 throwing the football, and he has one interception. He's going to go to the air again here. Another man wide open. It's Rocky Ross. But he stopped short of the first down. He needed to get out to the 32. He's dropped at about the 36.
I mean, nice tackle by Michael Jenkins. That's good. He's a good cover man, but again, you normally don't get beat by playing catch. Nice job breaking on the ball. Nice tackle.
Well, we've seen Central Florida pick it up throwing the football now. Of course, they have to.
They have to, and they've got to be in four down territory. They've got to make a first down here, keep the drive alive. Chains moving.
Kevin Smith, and he gets the much needed yardage. That is what we have not seen a lot of today.
Well, we haven't. We won't be able to see much of it to finish out because they're in a tough situation.
Number 32, Carlton Williams.
It was Curtis Francis.
First and 10, UCF, ball on the 30-yard line.
They're going to have to make some plays passing the football. They're not going to be able to run the football. But, again, I think Central Florida just like to be positive here and make some good things happen as the game progresses.
Dumps it off short. Francis again. That's going to be no gain on the play.
The number 21, Curtis Francis.
This is not a conference game for either one of these schools. So I think the thing you see is again, Central Florida can make some plays here, hopefully have a positive experience here somehow, some way, to finish this game off and then get into their conference schedule.
On second and 10, pump fake. Now deep to the end zone. Caught, but he was out of bounds. Sergio Joaquin made a beautiful catch, but he was out of bounds.
Number 87, Sergio Joaquin is in.
Again, the breaks just aren't with the Knights today.
Again, really a good call by the official. Sergio was just not able to get his foot down in bounds.
His feet are in the air.
Yeah.
And his butt came down out of bounds.
I think Central Florida ought to review this play. I think maybe his heel touched before he went out.
If the ball is snapped, they're going to lose the chance to review.
Exactly.
And it appears that they're ready to go forward with this play. No chance to review now on third and 10. The throw over the middle, in and out of the hands of A.J. Guyton, the true freshman receiver out of Homestead, Florida. If he makes that catch, they move the chains. Instead, fourth down coming up. Now penalty marker down.
There is no play. Ball start to 76. Offense, 5 yards. It remains third down.
So the penalty against Jaw Reed, the right tackle, number 76. And so they'll repeat third down here, so it's actually kind of a break for Central Florida.
Well, it is a break because they get the down over. Even though it's a penalty, it doesn't cost them a down. And I don't see the penalty here, but again, you'd like still make that catch.
Third down and 15.
So now third and 15. Boy, this community's been supportive of these Bulls, and a great crowd here today.
They've been supportive even when they weren't ranked fifth in the country. It's been a very supportive community. Tampa Bay Area's done a great job supporting the Bulls.
Israel goes down, ball comes loose. They're gonna rule it incomplete. Tyrone McKenzie, number 27, got in there. So did Nate Allen, the free safety.
Well, they're really attacking, and that's just the philosophy of Wally Berman. He's got great speed. He's going to attack. He's got blitz, got the corner and safety coming, and again, great pressure on Israel. No chance for Israel. They've had real struggle protecting for their passer to try to neutralize the South Florida speed, and I have not been able to do that. I'm a little surprised they're punting the football here.
Klingon and the fair catch by Marcus Edwards. Well, it's all South Florida now. 43-10. They're going to get the ball back here with 3 minutes to go. A penalty flag down on that last punt. Perhaps too many men on the field on Central Florida. We're going to get the call here.
We'll probably make them punt again if it is.
Illegal formation against the kicking team. Not enough men on the line of scrimmage. The penalty is declined. First down, USF.
A lot of mistakes for this team. It's almost as if it were the first game of the year instead of the sixth.
Yeah, too many mistakes.
Tyrone McKenzie made that last hit on Kyle Israel, and he is the team leader in tackles. He's an interesting story, Larry. He has transferred twice in his career, from Michigan State to Iowa State. Now from Iowa State here to South Florida, where he is reunited with Dan McCarney, who is the defensive line coach. He was granted an NCAA hardship. His mom was ill, so he wanted to transfer to South Florida to be closer to home. His mom is just 20 minutes away down the road in Riverview, and it's been a great situation not only for Mr. McKenzie, but also the South Florida program. He's an outstanding linebacker.
He's an outstanding player, and I think, again, NCAA, I think they do some things right, and I think that is the right decision. I had to come home, take care of his mother, and And certainly, I'm sure he's very happy to be able to play at this level of football in at his home home school.
Well, Greg Gregory is the offensive coordinator here at South Florida. This is his son, backup quarterback Grant Gregory, throwing incomplete, intended for Dontavia Bogan. And they've made the decision to rest Grothy here the rest of the way. Probably a pretty good decision.
Well, that's a pretty good decision. He could come back in if need be. But I think also they like Grant Gregory. He's a good football player. Transferred here from Indiana University. They're pretty high on him. And I think they need to see him because he may need to get some playing time later on in the year if Grothy's not able to play for a particular reason.
Greg Gregory, in his first year as the offensive coordinator here at South Florida, promoted to coordinating job after being the tight end coach the first 2 years on the job here. Rolling out, Gregory, it's deflected, out of play. Incomplete. Let's go to the studio for an update.
And Clay, Kyle Wright's roller coaster career continues. This play almost identical to the one you had, except opposite end zone, and except Sam Shields brings it in, tied at 14 now.
Yeah, Texas Colt McCoy continues to show his athleticism. Look at him. Oh, he's almost down. No, he's not down. He's back up. Throws it to Nate Jones, wide open for the touchdown.
35-3, Texas, Clay.
And Kyle Freeman. Kirby Freeman, excuse me, and Kyle Wright. It's been kind of a carousel there at Miami.
A little bit of a carousel. Kyle was hurt some last year, and Kirby started the year. Now it looks like Kyle is the starter.
Joe Burnett to return.
Joe Burnett back to return this punt. As the Bulls, for the first time today, go three and out. Penalty flag down on this play, too. A tough day back there for Joe Burnett. You'll remember that one play.
Right.
He touched, couldn't recover it, and South Florida took over at the 30-yard line.
Well, I think special teams, and I know the special teams coach coached this, is if you can't feel it, get away from him, because football is a funny shape. It takes crazy bounces, and you don't know
during
what bounce it's going to take.
Number 22, illegal block in the back on the receiving team. 10 yards, first down.
So a 53-yard punt. Tack on a few more on this play. And they're going to put it at the 18-yard line. So South Florida in the Big East, they're going to go to 6-0 overall. This will not improve their conference mark, but they're going to have momentum. They're going to continue with the momentum as they look forward to Rutgers and UConn the next 2 weeks.
Going to be a very tight conference schedule, and I think there will be maybe a team with one loss come out and win that league, but still several undefeated teams in the conference at this point.
We got UConn at Virginia later today on ESPNU. It's the game coming up after this one, and tell you what, are you surprised by the Huskies?
A little bit surprised by the Huskies.
There's another sack. This time, Aaron Harris, number 98, getting in and taking down the quarterback. Doesn't matter if it's Israel or Greco back there. It's been a tough day for the signal callers at Central Florida.
Well, Aaron Harris is an interior lineman, a defensive lineman, a defensive tackle. He has great speed for a defensive lineman. Normally, they're kind of meat men, kind of pluggers, but Aaron Harris gets off blocks, and he can really run. Very active football player.
Second down at 17. Greco, the southpaw, decides to run. Nowhere to go. George Selvey is there. Let's go to the studio and Mike Gleason.
Well, the Tennessee Volunteers, they've kicked, and Eric Ainge making sure that they've scored here. Little play action. Chris Brown gets in, 7-0 over Mississippi State. Heartbreaker for Illinois.
Yeah, Eddie McGee, quarterback for Illinois, driving his team down, trying to get in. Throws the interception. Brett Greenwood at the goal line.
Oh, only a minute to go on that one from Iowa City.
Yeah, Illinois rolling right along, 18th in the country. Their only loss had been to Missouri, but maybe going to go down today at the hands of Iowa. Third and 16 for Central Florida. They're down by 33 points. Greco thrown across his body and behind the intended receiver, Rocky Ross. Lands incomplete, and South Florida will get it back as Central Florida just going to have to punt.
Central Florida hasn't shown any continuity at all in the passing game, either protection-wise or catching the ball or throwing the ball. Nothing there in the passing game you've seen really believes they can get it done. Again, it's not their personality. They want to run the football first and use the play-action passing game. They haven't been able to do that, obviously, behind 43-10.
Blake Klingett has had tough field position for these punts all day. In the end zone again, but gets off a good one. Averaging 45 yards per kick. He's going to do much better than that this time. At the 39, here comes Marcus Edwards to the near sideline. He stood up and pushed back. 50-yard punt for Blake Klingett. Well, Matt Grothy is on the sideline, taking it easy, looking cool in that haircut. And you know what? He's deserved the rest because he had a good day in the first half. Didn't have a lot of work here in the third quarter, but he got it done, especially on the ground.
He really did get it done. And really, as a leader for his football team, and threw some outstanding passes that were dropped early in the first half, but really picked it up and gave his team what that team needed to be successful. I like the haircut. That's kind of interesting.
I don't know if I like it, but you know, it seems to fit his personality.
Did he start the game with that haircut, or did that happen at halftime? I don't know.
No, he started with it.
Oh, he started with it. Okay.
212 yards passing and 100 yards on the ground.
Well, he's an outstanding football player. He's still a young player. He just, I believe, a sophomore and newcomer of the year in the Big East a year ago. And if you're going to play against South Florida, you're going to have to do something about their defensive speed, and you're going to have to do something to contain this quarterback, Matt Grothy, because those two things are very special.
He's got a unique and distinct leadership quality about him. Just a sophomore, as you mentioned, but 14-4 now after today. Mm-hmm. We can assume that this is going to be a victory for South Florida. He will be 14-4 as the Bulls starter, and a lot of times you don't get that kind of leadership from underclassmen.
Well, you really don't, and you know, the respect comes from earning respect, especially with upperclassmen, and he's doing that. His teammates know he's the answer.
Well, that's going to do it for the third quarter. South Florida 43, Central Florida has a long way to go if they're going to get back into this one, but so far they've given us no indication that they're able to do that against this South Florida defense. Matt Grothy, his day is done. And a big lead for South Florida, 33 going to the fourth. ESPNU College Football presented by Allstate. From Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida. All South Florida as we get ready to start the fourth quarter. You take a look at the scoring by quarters. South Florida got on the board first and never looked back. And turnovers have been the Achilles heel for the Knights. Meanwhile, South Florida has done a good job protecting the football. Backup quarterback Grant Gregory hits Aston Samuels, Gregory's the fourth back. Running back to 20, get a touch Aston here Samuel. Today for South Florida. And too many turnovers in the first five games of the season was an issue. Despite the fact that they were winning the games, they knew they had to cut back in the turnovers, and South Florida has done that. They had 13 in the first five games, 11 in the last three, but none here today, Larry.
That's a great job protecting the football, and I think that's going to be the key as they finish up against these really good teams that they've got to play left. They've got to protect the football, and this is a good progress for them.
Over the middle, Amari Jackson. Look at all this running room. Inside the 20, finally caught from behind and tackled at the 13, but Amari Jackson with a big gain on the play. And South Florida's in the red zone one more time. Let's go to Mike.
And we go to the Carrier Dome. Ray Rice has his third touchdown, but Rutgers isn't done yet. And
the passing game is still clicking. Mike Till, the play action fake, going up top on a post route to his tight end, Kevin Brock, in for the touchdown.
38 points for Rutgers. South Florida has them next.
That's right, and looks like the Bulls will be undefeated still. 39-yard play for Amari Jackson on that last pass and catch.
Hit off the number 24, Sean Cannon.
Sean Cannon in the game now for USF.
Loss of one.
I think the thing you see for South Florida is that maybe a little disappointing. They haven't been able to consistently run the football, and I think that's something that they're going to continue to work on and improve on as the season goes on.
What a job Jim Leavitt has done with this program. 11 years ago, it didn't exist. And now it's the number 5 program in the country. They're going to go to 6-0 after today. Sean Cannon getting some work here as the Bulls have gone deep to their bench. Grant Gregory is running the offense now at quarterback. He's a junior and the son of offensive coordinator Greg Gregory. He's a transfer from Indiana, transferred out of that program in 2005. And he's very comfortable being the backup to Grothy here, and they like him. They feel that if Grothy were to go down with an injury or something of that nature, that Gregory would do just fine running this offense.
And they like him a lot, and they like his attitude.
He's going to the end zone here, and he's got a man touchdown.
They got to like that pass also. That's a great throw.
Torres Johnson with his second touchdown catch of the day. There's Greg Gregory. He's got to be happy with the pass his son just threw.
Alvarado into a
9-yard TD catch. Second for Johnson. Gregory put it in there very nicely. Extra point for Alvarado, and
the kick is good.
South Florida has put up a 50 spot.
UCF 10.
Pretty good football team, Larry.
Really good football team, and again, you see some young players coming in doing a good job.
It's 50 to 10. That's a 40-point game now, South Florida. Johnson with that 9-yard touchdown catch from Gregory. It's been a decade of success. Sure, there were some failures along the way to this point, but mostly success. I mean, it's been a meteoric rise for this program. From scratch, Jim Leavitt built this thing, and in 11 years, here they are. Curtis Francis going to let this bounce through the end zone. It'll be a touchback. Let's take a look at the history, Larry. And I mean, you expect things to move in a steady progression. But, I mean, this fast, I mean, to do what they've done?
You'd never guess that, and what a great job they've done. And obviously, Jim Leavitt deserves a great deal of the credit, but the staff he's put together, the support that the Tampa Bay area has given this program has been unbelievable, and the support that the university has. They're committed to this program and committed to football. And Jim Leavitt's committed not only to football, but he's committed to this university academically and athletically.
Well, Leavitt is a Tampa area native. He was at Kansas State as an assistant under Bill Snyder when he got the job. And he has not regretted it one bit. He wanted to come home and start this program. When he started, they had a $40,000 recruiting budget.
Tackle by number 4, Mike Jenkins.
Now the USF football recruiting budget is 4 times that amount. And they've gone from trailers to beautiful offices, which we were in yesterday. And they're the number 5 team in the nation.
Well, that's what I mean by commitment, because you can't do it by yourself. And a great commitment from the community and the university to really say, yeah, we want this program. We want you to have an opportunity to be successful. There's no guarantees, but that gives you an opportunity. And Jim Leavitt has taken the ball and run with it and been very successful with it.
Second down and 8. Greco still at quarterback, and he's being chased and dragged down from behind. Louis Cachette, the junior, strong safety, caught up with Greco and pulled him right down.
Defense was offside, I believe, which gives a little bit of a break to Central Florida.
There's an offside call. So that's going to wipe out the sack. But there has been pressure all day from that Central or South Florida defense.
I've been really impressed with their speed on defense, and they really play up to their speed. They play fast. I know Wally coaches them fast, and they're a very impressive football team, especially defensively.
On second and three, Curtis Francis is going to get the first down out to the 35-yard line. Jim Leavitt,
by number 21,
like
Curtis
I said
Francis,
before, was the assistant
by number
coach. I think he was in charge of the defense. Was he the assistant defensive coordinator under Bill Snyder? I believe that's the case at Kansas State back 12 years ago. And like I said, wanted to come home, start
first
this program
10,
up.
UCF,
he's done a great job. But if anybody had a blueprint to take a program from basically nothing, which the Kansas State program for all intents and purposes was, and take it to prominence, Bill Snyder had that blueprint. Jim Leavitt learned from that and has done basically the same thing here.
If anybody's ever worked a miracle in football, I think Bill Snyder's done it at Kansas State. He did a phenomenal job at Kansas State. This was a program, Kansas State, that people said could not win, that they couldn't win. And Bill Snyder proved them wrong.
And look at some of the guys who have learned from Snyder. Bielema, who's done amazing things in his short time at Wisconsin. Bennett at SMU, the Stoops brothers. Mark Mangino, hey, that Kansas team, they're
undefeated.
Ranked this week.
They're undefeated.
Yeah.
They just beat Kansas State last week. They've done a great job at the University of Kansas.
So not only has Snyder produced some great coaches that have gone on to head coaching jobs of their own, but they're all successful.
That's a good point. It's one thing to get a job, but then after you get it, what do you do with it? And they've done a great job, and he's got to be very proud of that legacy. The only legacy that would compare with it, I think, was Arkansas, the great coaches that Frank Broyles has put out. But certainly Arkansas program, yeah, a lot different than the Kansas State program.
Greco just throwing it away. All right, let's go to the studio and Mike.
Well, Clay, we mentioned that Alabama's three of the last four games have come down to the final play. This one, Mike, too. Ole Miss has retaken the lead on the Crimson Tide. Seth Adams to Michael Hicks, 18 yards, 24-17, Ole Miss.
Yes, Sylvester Croom Bulldogs are fighting away with a true freshman, Wesley Carroll. Throws it to his big receiver, Tony Burks, turns on the Jets, and for the touchdown.
Tennessee, Mississippi State tied at 7, Clay.
All right, gentlemen, thank you. Leavitt is still wound up tighter than
Coach,
come up with an analogy.
Leavitt will coach for four quarters now. He's not going to rest. He's going to coach the entire game.
His team's got a 40-point lead, and he is still over there giving the officials an earful. Sergio Joaquin, the 6'5 senior receiver, making that last catch. We talked to him yesterday, and you could tell that the new attention that his program is getting,
Trey Williams,
it's affecting him a little bit. He's an intense guy, but even more so now.
Well, I think so, because the things you hear, the things you read, sometimes it makes you a little uncomfortable because, you know, as I said earlier, there's no margin for error for this program. They have to win every game to get where they want to be. Now, are they ready to be there? I don't know. And I don't think Coach Leavitt knows that. But, again, in a position to be there, and when you're in a position to do that, you want to get it done.
Well, they've taken care of the business that they've had to take care of. Some of the critics say, yeah, they don't deserve to be there. But you know what? They can only do what they can do, and that's win football games. They've done that. We'll see what happens the rest of the way, but up to this point, they've been pretty impressive.
Well, I think Jim Leavitt knows that you're only as good as your last win, and they've got several more tough football games to play. They can win every one of those games, but again, he knows that. It's a lot of pressure on his players, a lot of pressure on him as a head coach and his staff.
We talked about they've got Rutgers next week, and then after that a pretty good UConn team on the road. Neither of those games are guineas. Boy, Greco stepped away from a sack, still not out of trouble. Now into the secondary, and he's got enough for the first down. Pretty good run there by Michael Greco, the backup quarterback.
Now Michael Greco can really run. He's got physical kid. He's a 4-4-4-5. For him to make that tight scramble and first down run against the South Florida defense, that's pretty good.
10, UCF.
Former North Carolina State signee who transferred to Central Florida from Pearl River Community College in Mississippi. Yeah.
I think Chuck Amato was the head coach at NC State at that time. Coach Amato now back at Florida State. Outstanding football coach.
First down and 10. A wobble on that pass. Somehow got to the receiver and it's caught.
Well, there was a wobble. He was hit just as he released the football, but had enough zip on the ball to get it into the receiver.
Brian Walters. It's Brian Walters. He's not listed on the 2 deep either, so it looks like Central Florida has also gone deep to their bench. So South Florida, with the win here today, becomes bowl eligible for the third straight year. That also speaks to what Jim Leavitt has done with this program. Not only has he turned it into a national player, but he's built some consistency into this program, too, because for 3 years in a row now, they're bowl eligible.
Well, I think he's also created a little bit of a monster, because I don't think he wants to hear, or his fans wants to hear, hey, we're bowl eligible. They want more than that. They're a little bit hungry right now in South Florida.
On the carry, tackle by number 7.
They want more than just a bowl.
Here's a look at the top 10 of the AP Top 25. And
gain of 5.
I mean, there are still some very good teams ahead of South Florida who also have not lost this year. We saw Boston College last week. Ohio State's got Kent State today, so you got to think that the Buckeyes will be 7-0 after this week. Plus, LSU, you know, even though they've had a couple of scares, they're undefeated. How would South Florida match up with those teams, those four teams that are ahead of them?
Well, I think they'll match up some, but I think a team like LSU, they're unbelievably talented. They're probably the most talented team in the country, in my opinion, this year. And I think, you know, week in, week out, I think they have a tough time matching up. You know, one-game series, a one-game playoff, yeah, they might match up okay. Their defensive speed would. I think South Florida would probably need to be able to pass the football better than run the football consistently, more consistently than they did today.
Well, Grothy certainly got it done on the ground, but really nobody else. And that probably is a concern. 3rd and 7. Greco being chased and pulled down. I think that was Aaron Harris again. Yes, it was. And he has had a good day. The defensive tackle from Williston, Florida. He was planning to redshirt last year, but injuries made him too valuable, so he played, and here is his sophomore. You can see that he's an experienced veteran.
Experienced veteran with a lot of speed. You see here, I'm surprised Greco didn't throw this away. Maybe Greco's lack of experience here, but just throw the ball away and live to play another day.
4th sack today for this South Florida defense, the 3rd for Harris. Clinging with another punt. And are they going to say this was in the end zone or down at the 1? They're going to mark it down at the 1. Nice play by Central Florida. That was Francis back there. Curtis Francis, the 3rd string running back who made a great play on special teams. All right, when we come back, another round of bull or no bull. And this is going to be the rubber match between you and I, Larry. I think we're pretty close. We'll see who wins. Coming up.
Hey, Clay. Can you hear me?
South Florida on top 50-10. And we've got 6:53 to go here in the football game. All right, Larry, you're up 6-5 going into the final round of Bull or No Bull, the game show that we've put together here. And we're trying to learn some more about South Florida, a lot of nuggets and trinkets and interesting information, and so far you've done pretty well.
The pressure mounts.
Yeah, it really does. All right, Stan Heath is the new head basketball coach at South Florida, and he is going to be the Pat Sajak, so to speak, of this round. And Stan, we're going to get to your questions here in just a minute. 1st and 10 on the South Florida 1 after a great special teams play by Curtis Francis. And Gregory still running the offense, and this is going to be a safety for South Florida. This is the 2nd time we've seen a safety today. You don't see that very often in a game, but that's the case here. So Central Florida is going to get the 2 points and get the football back. All right, let's play bull or no bull. And Stan, you still down there with us?
I'm here.
And you've got, who is
that?
I've
got my Kentrell Gransbury, my senior center, leading rebounder in the nation, standing next to me.
All right, guys. All right, you've got the questions, Kentrell?
Yes, sir.
All right, fire away.
Incorporated December 15, 1855, Tampa, one of the world's leading phosphate exports, is known as the Cigarette City.
Cigarette City, what do you say?
The Cigar City, I'd say that's no bull.
Tampa is also known as the Big Guava.
Okay.
Sir?
I'm going to say bull.
Coca?
Oh, yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. I say no bull on that.
No bull is the answer.
All right, so I lose again. Now I'm down two. I have to get the next two just to tie.
Here you go.
All right, Cantrell, go ahead.
When they debuted against San Diego State in their first Division I-A game in 1999, the USF Bulls sported purple uniforms that are believed to be inspiration for the Clay Magdovic shirt today. Have at it, guys.
Oh, that's bull. I know that's bull.
Okay, inside joke. Bull.
The answer is bull.
All right, good.
Next question. Trademarked in 1974 and redesigned in 1984 and 1996 USF mascot's full name is Rubber Q Bull.
I'm going to say no bull.
I'm going to say bull.
Bull is the answer. The mascot's official name is Rocky D. Bull.
Rocky D. Bull. Okay.
I like that.
Yeah. All right, Central Florida is going to get it back here with 6:40 to play. And this is Francis on the return. All right, Kentrell, you're the leading rebounder, not only in the Big East, but the entire nation. What are you looking for this season?
I'm just looking to come out and have the same repeat performance as last year and better my team to get to the NCAA tournament and hopefully a Big East championship and a Big East tournament bid.
How about the coaching change? Does that worry you at all?
It's not really. Any coach you play for, you're going to have to get to know them and get to know the offense and the chemistry with the new coaching staff. So it's not really bothering me at all, just getting the guys together and having great team chemistry and so forth.
Hey, the coach is standing right beside you. I better not bug you too much, right?
No, sir.
Stan, how about the move from Arkansas to South Florida? Your thoughts on being in the Tampa Bay area now?
Well, it's hard to complain, and it's a great place to live. What an exciting time to come here with so much electricity around our community in the Bay Area with our football team doing so well. So, I'm excited to be here. I'm looking forward to our season. We've got some work to do, and we've had 2 days of practices, and we're getting better.
Stan, you're in a tough league. Obviously, you came from a tough league, but the Big East is a tremendously tough league. A lot of great basketball teams, and some of them don't play football, but really prominent basketball teams. How do you see this league?
Great basketball league, as you mentioned, and just 16 teams, and top to bottom, there's no easy games at all, and every night it's going to be a war. We've just got to strap them up and play hard, go out there, leave it on the floor, but I think that's what we want to do. We want to play against the best, and we're in one of the best conferences in America.
Stan, you've got a tough act to follow after this football team, what they're doing. I'm sure it's your hope that you can generate that kind of excitement.
Well, I'm hoping that, I look at our student section and you see 12,000 students screaming and yelling, and I'm hoping that just carries right over into basketball and we just have a great home court environment in the Sun Dome, and no reason that can't happen, and it's happened before.
All right, Stan, Kentrell, good luck to the Bulls this basketball season. We appreciate your time.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you.
All right, guys. Third down and 10 for Central Florida. 50-12 our score. We've seen two safeties in this game, and that one's going to land incomplete. All right, the final score in bull or no bull. I think you won. There it is. 9-6.
All right,
I got
yeah.
routed. And this is what you get for winning bull or no bull. You got to put it on.
I like that.
I'm not going to let you off that easy. You got to put that hat on. So now you're the king of bull, I guess.
Yeah, I fit in pretty good there. I like that. Yeah. I like that. Is it on right? Yeah, there we go.
Well, you got the headset on.
Well, I know.
Plus, you've got an abnormally large head.
I feel like...
What's the consolation prize? Oh, I get the home game. There it is, the fabulous bull or no bull home game that I can play with my friends at home. Very great. Wonderful.
What a great prize. I love this. I like this.
So now the challenge is, what are we going to do next week for a side game?
I don't know. We'll figure out something.
Thanks for bearing with us at home. as we play Bull or Noble. We've got a timeout in the field. And it's called by South Florida. Boy, this has been an impressive day here for South Florida. They put up a lot of points in spite of the fact that, you know, they didn't run the ball all that well. Grothy didn't connect with a lot of receivers, especially early on, but still took advantage of turnovers, and they turned a lot of mistakes into points.
Sometimes you just don't figure out how things are going to turn out. They did what they needed to do to score a lot of points and to win the football game impressively.
And that's something that the coaching staff was worried about, as there's a penalty flag down in that play. They had been getting a lot of turnovers. The defense had forced a lot of turnovers in the five games prior to this one, but they hadn't been able to turn those turnovers into a lot of points, but they did that today.
They did a great job today. And the touchdown in the first half was a huge play for South Florida. And really, you just didn't see the rhythm in Central Florida's offense at all. They just really weren't able to connect and do things that they needed to do, especially once they got behind.
George O'Leary still hoping that his team can contend in that East Division in Conference USA. They're going to be down a little bit emotionally after this one today. We've got a conference down on the field. Referee coming over to talk with Jim Leavitt.
Jim Leavitt's going to coach until the final whistle blows. He's not going to relax. And I think that's the way he wants his team to play.
Let's find out what the call is. Here's Gil Gelbke.
We have two fouls on the play. We have holding number six of the receiving team during the kick. That penalty will be enforced. We have kick catch interference against the kicking team. That penalty is declined in order for USF to keep the ball, which is their choice, first down.
.6:14 to go. We're going to take a break.
It takes strength.
All USF. We'll wrap this one up when we come back. ESPNU College Football is presented by Allstate. Are you in good hands?
Oh, man, be sure to join us for the next
home game. Leroy Selman's restaurant. Went there last night with Doug Willard, the athletic director here at South Florida, and Todd Jones, Anthony DeMarco from former producing and directing staff. And you and I ate pretty well last night over there. I had the pulled pork. What did you have? Did you have the barbecue ribs?
No, I had pulled pork, but I tell you, at the end of the meal, the peach cobbler, I think Leroy made that himself, or some of his family in Eufaula, Oklahoma made it, because it was outstanding with a big dip of ice cream on mine. Great place. Enjoyed it.
People around the Tampa Bay area love Leroy Selman. Of course, the only Tampa Bay Buccaneer in the Hall of Fame.
They should love Leroy Selman. He was a great player at Oklahoma, won almost every defensive lineman award. He's in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. And not only that, a terrific student athlete, a great, great, he was academic All-American along with being a great football All-American.
And he's still part of this South Florida program. At one point was the associate athletic director. Now he's the president of Foundation Partnerships for Athletics. So he's involved heavily with this Bulls football program. And they've really done a great job here, and he's been a part of it.
Well, you're sitting there with Jack Pardee presenting the trophy. And the thing, I think, with Leroy Selman, I talked to him before the game. Looks like he could still play.
He's
a very impressive person. And just I just can't describe what a great football player he was.
Grant Gregory in the game, and he's going to have a touchdown maybe here. Great catch by Carlton Mitchell. Nobody's going to catch it. Second touchdown pass for Grant Gregory. Matt Grothy's backup. 75 yards on that play. Carlton Mitchell, the Bulls' number four receiver, with his second touchdown catch of the year.
The Bulls have had some of those opportunities early in the game, and again, it just didn't connect, either a poor throw or a couple of drops. But that was a great throw and great protection. And again, as you see with Grant Gregory. You can see the potential he has.
Alvarado into attempt the extra point.
Gregory now 4 for 6, 125 yards passing and 2 touchdowns. And that's in mop-up duty. Alvarado with the extra point. And it's 57-12. Let's go to the studio in Charlotte and Mike with an update.
And in the SEC, Clay, it looks like Mississippi State, Tennessee will have a good one on their hands. Here comes Anthony Dixon, taking it to the house, and now Mississippi State up by a touchdown, 14-7. Coming up right after your game, we go to Charlottesville, undefeated UConn against 5-1 Virginia. Chris Long, Howie's kid, he'll be playing on Sundays. Doug Bell and Charles Arbuckle will have that call right after your game.
All right, that should be fun. And we've seen Virginia already this year, and Mr. Long is impressive.
Well, he's the real deal. And for our viewers that don't know, you know, Howie Long, his father is a great football player, not just a guy that did commercials with Terry Hatcher, the Desperate Housewife. He was also a great football player. And his son is terrific, I tell you. He's the epitome of what a defensive lineman should be.
Definitely has the bloodlines. No. We'll have that game in Charlottesville coming up in moments. This is Curtis Francis from the 5. And penalty flags come in on this play.
Returned by number 21, Curtis Francis. Flags on the play.
So can Central Florida bounce back from this loss? I know it's a loss to the number 5 team in the country, but it would be it's tough to take a lot of positives from this one, I would think, if you're Central Florida.
No doubt about it. It's not only the number 5 team in the country. Is it?
Number 36 of the receiving team. That's a 10-yard, half the distance penalty. First down.
It's a team that's 82 miles apart, and again, it's deeper than just losing to a regular football game. And I think it's going to be difficult to bounce back. I think George O'Leary, the experience he has, his staff, they'll get that done, but not an easy task.
Michael Greco under center. Hands off to Phillip Smith. Hasn't touched the ball a lot today. And 1 yard pickup on that play. Smith is the second leading rusher on this UCF team, which shows you how much they rely on Kevin Smith. I mean, Phillip Smith had 125 yards on the ground coming in to the game today, and he's the second leading rusher.
Well, Kevin Smith is their go-to guy, and defenses will know that. They'll stack up to stop Kevin Smith, and they get him stopped, as it looks like that's going to make it tough for Central Florida.
And that's what South Florida has done today. Smith again doesn't even get back to the original line of scrimmage. That's going to be a loss of probably 2 or 3 yards of it. Coming up on 4 minutes to go. Dante Spires, the backup weak side linebacker, made that last tackle. Next week, you and I will be in Death Valley. We're going to Clemson to see a homecoming for the Tigers as they take on Central Michigan.
Clemson's a great college atmosphere. I've only been there once. Played there in double overtime. It's a great place to play and a great student body. It'll be alive and active in Clemson.
A lot of third down and long situations today for the Knights. And they haven't converted a whole bunch of them. This one batted down at the line. And now Central Florida is 2 for 13 on third down, but there is a penalty flag. All right, let's go to Doug Bell and Charles Arbuckle in Charlottesville, UConn and Virginia.
Mike Leeson back at SportsCenter U. We kicked off the day down in Tampa with Central Florida in South Florida. 64-12 with about 68 seconds to go. Coming up, it's Rutgers, UConn, and Cincinnati. USF now 6-0 after the next minute 8. Let's go back to Charlottesville, Doug and Buck.
This is the Husky package, I like to call it, as we watch tape. Two tight ends, Big Lou Allen, He's trying to get to that first down mark, and he gets sent backwards by the Cavaliers.
Hey, I don't care how big you are. If you don't play with leverage and you come in there kind of going slow, you'll get knocked back.